What's up, everybody? My camera's not working. That's not a great start. Hold on one second. Come on, DSLR. Come back to life. Here it comes. And 3, 2, 1. There it is. My name's Aaron Ciotti. Everybody just calls me Ciotti. You can call me Mr. McGillicuddy. And today we're going to be doing the ultimate freestyle Tiny Whoop build with help from BetaFPV and TinyWhoop.com. Check those guys out, making some awesome stuff. And we're going to use some of their awesome stuff to build, possibly, we're going to try to build the ultimate freestyle Tiny Whoop. Judging, so we're going for a couple things here. We're going as lightweight as we possibly can. And we're going for sort of cinematic smoothness in a weird way by looking at motors that have bearings in them. So that is one of the ways that I chose the parts for this build, also with durability in mind. Yeah, so kind of one whoop to end them all. So let's dig into it. Switch cameras here, and we'll talk about the components that have been chosen here. This is the Meteor 65 frame, which is pretty well known to be the lightest and the most durable frame available. This flight controller here is BetaFPV's, let me just pull it up here on the monitor real quick. It's their F4-1S brushless flight controller V2.2, and this guy is FR Sky because that's what I fly. These are BetaFPV's 0802 22,000 kV motors, and it's the current generation, which does have bearings, which is pretty exciting. This guy here is the Tiny Whoop Pinch Cam, brand new. I believe this is the lightest camera available, and I've used Tiny Whoop's, this style cam where the VTX is separate from the camera housing. I've used these before, and they've just been incredible. They're made by FXT, and FXT makes some really good stuff. Again, shout out to BetaFPV. Those guys sent over this flight controller and these motors, as well as another flight controller for testing. Unfortunately, it took me a while to get this going here, but yeah, better late than never, I guess. We're going for the Gemfan quad blades. I spoke with SR13, who I consider to be the best freestyle whoop pilot in the world, and he's done a lot of testing of props and said that for the little props, these guys are the ones you want. The four-blade Gemfans are the jam. This is actually a prototype, but I think that these are now available. This is a prototype whoop canopy from TinyWhoop.com. Jesse Perkins runs TinyWhoop.com, and he has a guy who makes these canopies for him. And this is the new generation that's set up for the Pinch Cam. They basically squished everything down. The Pinch Cam is much smaller, so it's much lower. And that's what this canopy was made for, to have the front hole a lot lower, and just the whole canopy is a lot lower, so it should be super low profile. And then the thing that's going to probably take the most time in this build is this antenna, believe it or not. So I got this Tiny Whoop Pinch Cam with the CP antenna on it, just because it's the only one that was in stock. But I knew I was going to switch it out. Being a freestyle Tiny Whoop, without HD built in, I think we still have a ways to go on the HD side. It's still kind of heavy for Tiny Whoops. But being as that it is going to be a freestyle rig, I want to try to get as good quality video as I can into the goggles and then into the immersion power play that I use as my DVR. And we're going to do it with this TrueRC Singularity antenna. And what we're actually going to do is chop this thing down, separate the outer from the inner, and then I'm going to show you guys how to remove an antenna from a VTX where the antenna is direct soldered to it. And then you're going to get to see how to install an antenna like this that's just, just has the raw end on it onto a VTX without a UFL, without an MMCX, without any of the other connectors. On a Tiny Whoop, I think it's perfectly valid to direct solder the antenna, especially when it's an antenna like this that's going to be plenty durable. So, this will get direct soldered onto that VTX and it'll pretty much stay there forever. So let's get to work. Always wanted to do that. All right, I just dropped the prop. There it is. All right, so we're going to start by just putting some stuff together. In the chat, if you want me to see your chat, what you need to do is type my name, CIADFPV, into the chat. What that's going to do is it's going to light your comment up in orange for me so that I can see it. So the first person that did that was CMYKFPV, saying literally the most majestic footage of all time. Then we've got Zach Barnes, who tagged me and says, hey there, spacing out a whoop and 5-inch build, going to decide on the one, looking forward to the build. Thanks, brother. So yeah, as you guys have any questions about tiny whoops or life or anything really, just hit me with them. I probably won't see them immediately, but as long as you've tagged me and my name is lit up in orange, I will see it eventually and give you an answer. So let's dig in. The first thing we're going to do is just bolt these motors on, just kind of the one of the simpler things to do, but it does take some time. So yeah, hit me with those questions, guys. Since we don't have any questions yet, I guess I'll just start rambling about my Tiny Whoop background. I believe the second rig that I ever built slash bought, although I guess I built it. Yeah, I built it. I've never bought a Tiny Whoop, to be honest with you guys. I've always just built them from scratch. The very first one was very early on. I think it was my second rig ever. Very early on in this hobby, I was unemployed when I started this hobby, so I didn't have any money. And I also kind of thought, well, I don't know if I'm going to be able to handle this. Like, I don't know if my thumbs are going to really work on the controller, and maybe I don't think it's that fun, or all things that seem insane now. I mean, it's flying, right? How can flying not be fun? But you just don't know when you get started. So my very first rig was a 2.3-inch, actually. It was the Emax's original white plastic Baby Hawk. And then I'm pretty sure my second rig was a Tiny Whoop that I built from scratch with a bunch of newbie drone parts. And I've had a bunch of whoops since then. I'm kind of known as the micro guy or the micro king, as Stinger Swarm crowned me at Quad Camp Atlanta 2 or so years ago. So Tiny Whoops kind of fit right in with that, even though they are a little bit different. Back then, they were brushless, and trying to get the PID tunes on them really locked in was a bit more of a challenge than with the current brushless. But you've always been able to get them tuned in once you did enough kind of work on the PIDs. I remember back in the brushless days, is there anything that I haven't dropped yet? Should I just pick everything up and drop it back down on the desk at this point? Back then you had to run your P's and up into like the 90s and the 100s, if not more, and then your D gains were up really high as well. On some of the, basically, if you've got a brushless whoop that's a little bit overpropped, you kind of have to do the same thing. You have to make up for the lack in motor power by just going crazy on the PIDs to get a really locked-in tune. But what I will say is some of these new, some of these new whoops, you can really get a motor and prop package that perform incredibly well. And I'm really a fan of these 0802s. I know that there's 0803s and there's 0603s, but I really think that these 0802s are kind of the answer. The only other motor size that I would want to try would actually be an 0902. I would love to see an 0902. My guess is that it would be a little heavy. Tiny Whoops really, I won't say struggle, but you have to be careful with the weight of a Tiny Whoop. If you add a gram, you feel it. Mainly because adding a gram is like adding 5% weight. So you scale that 5% up and think about a 600 gram 5-inch rig, right? Add 5% of the weight to that and you're gonna feel that, right? That's 5, 6, 30, that's adding 30 grams. That's a lot, right? That's going from a Session 5 to a Hero 7 or a Hero 8. And if you've ever done that, you can't tell me that you didn't feel the difference, because it is immediately apparent. So with Tiny Whoops, you really have to watch those grams and just build as absolutely light as you can. Eric Allen says, back for more. He's referring to the fact that I've been streaming for 3 hours already today. Hit my channel to check out the, I did another Whoop build a little bit earlier with 75mm props, actually. I haven't done, wait, no, the props aren't 75. I guess the frame is 75. I've actually never built a Whoop with the bigger props. I've only ever done 65mm Whoops, which is kind of like the OG sizing. And that was really interesting. I'm really glad that I built that. Those bigger propellers have... I knew there'd be a difference, but I didn't quite think there'd be this much of a difference. It definitely feels bigger and smoother, and yeah, I kind of like it. It's quite a bit heavier, which when we're talking about something that you're going to fly inside, I, for example, live in a very small apartment here, about 1,200 square feet. And so, again, you really have to be careful of the weight if you don't want to, you know, destroy everything that you own. But, yeah, other than that, it felt fantastic. The bigger props seemed to give it a little bit more float, almost, which I know is kind of crazy when we're talking about inside, but I don't know, it just felt like it had a little bit more hang time to it, which makes sense, going from... you know, when again, you got to think about everything in percentages when you're down this small. And when you look at the percentage difference, it's significant between the small guys and the bigger guys, the smaller props and the bigger props. So yeah, always make sure that you get your rubber grommets on here, and always put them on before the before you put the board onto the frame itself, or you will just hate life. They really need to be on here before. And now, there, you could say that there's two different ways of doing this. Most people have this as the front here, but with the wider field of view cameras, you can then see this little point. So I actually make this the front. I run this as the front of the rig, just because it looks, it's a little bit lower profile than that, like it doesn't hang out as far, and it just looks a little bit more normal. This hard edge versus the round ducts, I don't know, I just like the way this looks better in the field of view. And when you're mounting this guy, always look at the location of the USB port. That's going to be in the rear. So let's just bend these guys down. Beta FPV very kindly puts these BT 2.0 connectors on their rigs, which is fantastic. From the factory. I also have not used one of these guys yet, so this is going to be, I'm really looking forward to it. I've of the testing that's been done, it certainly seems like the BT 2.0s are the way to go in terms of weight versus efficiency and resistance. So there we go. Push that all the way down there, and now the camera setup that I'm using here, for the camera itself, it only uses the left and right, as you can see, holes to hold it on. So that means we should be able to screw the front and back down, but we also want to look at the canopy just to make sure. And the canopy is the same. It just uses the left and right. It leaves the rear opened, and the front, it just covers up the front screw. So we can start putting our screws in here to hold the AIO board down to the frame. The only thing I want to stop and think about, though, is I am going to have to... So the receiver is built into this frame, but the camera is not. So I'm going to have to run... this new pinch cam from Tiny Whoop has video in, video out, and smart audio. So I need to think for a second where those are going to be. And it looks like it's just those four. I'm actually also going to have to look up the wiring diagram here. Thought it was, or no, maybe not. Maybe it's on this little insert piece of paper. Let's take a quick look. And nope, it is not. It just says go to our website. So let's, oh boy. So let's do that. Let's head over to their website and we'll have a look. All right, good to go. Let's see here. Hello, everyone.
Where are we at? Okay, so there is the flight controller. Looks like it's 2.7 grams. It's got OSD, it's got BT 2.0, all the good things. Let's find a little wiring diagram here. What do you say? There we go. Okay, so battery plus and minus we don't need to worry about because they put that BT 2.0 on there already. What we're worried about here is smart audio, camera, 5-volt ground, and VTX. We're going to use all of these. And now that I see that they're tiny little through hole, they have tiny little through holes for them. Well, we're going to look in a second to see if our wires are skinny enough to get in there. I have a feeling that they're not going to be. I have a feeling that we're going to need to flat solder to the top of those pads, which is completely fine. On the bottom here, we've got the F4. We've got a couple LEDs, the motor pads, and the USB port. Oh, and it looks like there's two different... Oh, okay, so I see. So this is the diagram for FR Sky, which is what I've got, and then they have a separate set for DSMX, and maybe they even have another for... oh, okay, so this is version 2.1, and then when I go up here, let me guess, this is version 2.2. Okay, so that's something that we need to do. We need to figure out if we've got 2.1 or 2.2. Maybe it says somewhere on the board... But to be honest, let's just line the boards up and we'll just look at the picture versus the way that the chips are kind of laid out on the board. And that's usually how I can figure that out. So when I look at the top of the board, there's a, it looks like it's a receiver chip here that's at a 45 degree angle. So let me check the other one, the 2.1, to see if it has the same. Yeah, it does. Okay, so let's keep looking for other things that might be different. We've got square, square, square. Okay, so we've got like the center. Let's see if the center looks the same. It does. All right, so let's look at the bottom here. We've got five little holes left and right, and then a couple there. So let's see how that compares to the 2.1. Pretty much looks the same. All right, so let's check the bottom of the board. Maybe there's some obvious differences on the bottom. So we've got our boot and bind button, and we've got a couple capacitors down there. Oh, okay. I think I figured it out. I think I have a 4 point. I think I have the 2.2. Let me just double check something here. So it's got, I'm looking right in here above the USB port, and I think I've spotted a difference. Okay, so I'm just making like a mental note of this right here. And now I'm going to scroll up to version 2.2, and sure enough, I have version 2.2. Okay, so this is the area that you guys can look at right here above the USB port, where there are some def... Oh, and look, there, it just says it right there. Or just look at the silk screening right there that says V2.2, which mine does as well. Ah, look at that. The V2.1 has silk screened on it. V2.1. Okay. So we've got the V2.2. If you're new to the channel, welcome. This is how we do it. We figure it out as we go. And we have been for the last year or so. All right. So license to drive has a question. Shoot me a, do me a favor, license. I'm at Ciotti FPV. All over the place. Facebook, Instagram, Patreon, link down below to that. If you guys want to support what I'm doing here, as well as here on YouTube, do me a favor, license, shoot me a message on Facebook. I'm trying to keep this build as short as possible. So yeah, shoot me a message. We will talk through that. Looks like CMYK also has a question about surges. I've never done
a capacitor on a Tiny Whoop. It's not gonna hurt. I mean, it's putting a capacitor on a rig is always a good idea. So if you have the space, it's never gonna hurt things. But I've not really had any, I don't think, Tiny Whoop boards let go on me that would make me even think about doing a capacitor on them. So yeah, I don't know. It's it can't possibly hurt other than weight. I mean, they do weigh something. And we are being very sensitive to weight on Tiny Whoops. But other than that, yeah, I mean, I see a lot of guys put them on the battery leads, and that's a really good spot to put them. So those pads, I just did that. Okay, and I forgot to switch the camera.
So, all right, let me switch the camera here, and I'm also going to give you guys a little bit of zoom when I'm working on these tiny little pads, and let me also lock the focus in here because this camera does not do a great job at pulling autofocus for me. All right, so I did just tin these pads here, but I'm gonna just give them a little bit more solder so that you guys can actually see what I'm doing this time. So there we go. And now I've got a little solder blob of wet solder on the tip of the iron. I'm not actually touching the tip of the iron to these pads. I'm literally just touching the blob of solder to the pad. And what's nice is the solder transfers the heat really, really efficiently. So that's one of the tricks of soldering tiny, tiny, tiny little pads. And these are pretty small, I gotta admit. These are pretty small pads. You're gonna want a pretty relatively fine tip on your soldering iron. You're also gonna really want a set of super, super, super needle nose tweezers, just so that you can better hold the wires to get everything in there. I did say that I was gonna check to see if these wires would go through the holes, but I'm pretty sure that they wouldn't. So, and I've already tinned them, so we're just gonna skip that. All right, so we've got those pads tinned. That is kind of step one of getting this camera all soldered up. Next thing we need to do is get these wires all figured out. So we've got a bunch of wires on this pinch camera. Let me zoom back out, and I'm also going to put autofocus back on. All right, so here's the pinch camera in its 3D printed mount that you also get from tinywhoop.com. And we've got a whole bunch of wires coming off here, but it's nowhere near as confusing as it looks. Right here, big long wire with what appears to be a 1S connector on the end. This is your voltage wire. This is getting power in to the actual camera and VTX itself. What's actually happening is you're powering the VTX, but then the VTX has a set of red and blacks here that run power up to the camera. So this is what we need to run power, and we can pick. We can either run this off of the 5-volt pad that we were just working off of, or sometimes you can run this off of the battery leads. We're going to put this on the 5-volt pad so that this gets five-volt BEC power. If you run your camera off of the battery leads, they're going to get like 4.3, 4.35-ish when the battery starts, and then that voltage is going to lower and lower and lower as the battery gets more and more dead. So it's better to run it off of the 5-volt and ground pads that they've given us there, because that's piggybacked off of a BEC, a 5-volt BEC, which is boosting the voltage coming in up to 5-volt and also keeping that 5-volt steady. So now we've got three more wires. Two of them are yellow and one of them is white. The coloring of the wires is a big clue. Yellow is video. Pretty much always yellow wires are used to carry video. And then that would make the white the smart audio cable. So we've got two yellow cables though, but it's very easy to figure out what's going on because of where they are. This yellow cable is up here connected directly to the camera. This yellow cable is down here connected to the VTX. So what we want to do is send the camera yellow wire, because that's the raw camera feed. We want to send that into the flight controller, because the flight controller is then going to put that into the OSD chip up here. It's going to then put OSD on it, and then we've got a VTX pad on this that is going to send the video signal with the OSD added out. And that's what we're going to use this other yellow wire here for, that's connected directly to the VTX. And then the VTX is going to send that signal into the antenna and through the air to our goggles. So let's get to work on that. I almost feel like I kind of want to take this
Oh, well, you know what? Here. We're not going to use this. And so these CP antennas with the exposed lobes like this, these are incredibly fragile. So I don't even care. I'm literally throwing this in the garbage because I ruined these on the first crash. The first crash, it breaks right here between the two lobes, and then any actual ability to carry video is pretty much shot to shit, and you're kind of just dealing with a naked VTX at that point with almost no antenna. So there we got that, and first thing I'm going to show you guys is how to remove the existing antenna. What I just did there is going to make it a little bit harder, but that's okay. We're still going to be able to get this just fine. So I got you guys zoomed in as much as I can here. We're going to see how bad the... I'm going to lock the focus again. Just because I don't trust it. Alright, so there we go. I'm going to move this just a little bit away. And... Alright, so I've got the soldering iron at 640 degrees. That's kind of like a good round number in the middle. What I'm going to try to do, there's a big bridge of solder going over the top of this. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the tip of the iron on there. I'm going to wait until it flows and liquefies. And then I'm just going to do this move to try to flick some of this solder off. I'm trying to remove some of this solder. So here's another kind of trick. If you put a little tiny bit of solder on the tip of your iron here and then you go in, it's going to transfer the heat a lot better. So just a little bit, because we don't want to add to the solder, right? The whole point of this is we're trying to remove solder. See it flow, and now we're going to pull. And that actually, that worked better than I could have ever imagined. So that pulled, wow, that was really cool. So that pulled the outer bit of the conductor straight on off, and that's absolutely perfect. So now all I've got is the inner conductor which connects to a tiny little pad on there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in here with my tiny little tweezers, and I'm going to grab, I'm going to grab what's left of this and just hold it, and then I'm just going to put heat up on the tip there. I know it's hard for you guys to see, but if you ever have to do this, it'll be really obvious. There's a tiny little nub at the front, and that's all it took. It's just the tiniest little nub, and the back part here is a big flat. Let me see if I can hold it up for you guys to see a little bit better. And let me also bring this light down. So here's the part, the flat part in the back here that connects to the outer braid of the UFL. And then right there, that little circle, that's what touches the inside. And it's gonna make a lot more sense when we cut the singularity antenna up. It's gonna make sense what each one of these is getting soldered to. So just hold off on that. That'll make a lot more sense in, I don't know, 5-10 minutes or so. Can you guys wait that long? Better be able to, because you don't have a choice. All right, so that's good to go. Now we just have more space to work. So let's go back to the flight controller here. Well, the AIO, I should say. And let's do some soldering. So TinyWhoop and FXT, they give you a whole bunch of cable here. Don't leave all this cable. Chop these guys down, restrip, retin these wires. Again, in TinyWhoops, we're trying to save every single gram that we possibly can. Steve-O with a really good question. Do you not have a solder sucker? I do not, Steve-O. My father has been an electrical engineer for 30 plus years, and his standpoint on solder suckers is that basically all they end up doing is lifting pads. So below each one of these copper pads is adhesive and then the PCB. And the adhesive is what we want to be careful of. And the adhesive failing is why pads lift. And what the solder sucker does is as soon as you, when you pull that plunger back, it's a physical plunger in there. When you push the button on the solder sucker, the plunger ramps forward and the entire solder sucker bashes into the board. It's hard to feel because the whole thing is moving, but if you look really close, you can watch the solder sucker bash into the board. So if you've already put heat on the pad and then you've got this big thing banging into that pad, that's a really good way to move the copper of the pad on the adhesive and that's how you will then get a pad that lifts. It probably won't lift right then and there. It'll probably lift the next time you have to take the rig apart. So in my father's much more qualified opinion, also as a side note, the guy was trained to solder by NASA, so he knows what he's doing. And the soldering work that he was doing was on a tokamak nuclear fusion reactor. So yeah, he wasn't just like hawking TVs in the back. He was doing some pretty serious stuff, and everything that he's ever told me has been absolutely dead on the money. So yeah, throw your solder suckers in the bin as far as I'm concerned. All right, so let's do a quick mock-up. So this this camera plate that's holding the camera, this 3D printed plate, it is going to be sitting up on the rubber gummies a little bit, but I'm just pushing it down flat to kind of get, worst case scenario is one way to say it, but so let's cut all of these wires so that they're long enough to reach the furthest back possible pad. And we'll actually cut a little bit more. So the furthest back pad is basically right there. So for this one, I'm just gonna give it a little bit extra slack like we've been talking about. And I think I'm gonna cut it right back there. So that's probably gonna be just about enough. And now we've got our power wire here, which we are gonna hook up to that 5-volt pad like we've been talking about. And now this wire is twisted up like this. That's not for any kind of electrical interference or anything like that. There is a thing called twisted pairs. It does have an effect on incredibly sensitive systems, but in the systems that we're working with, it really doesn't do anything. I've tried it multiple times. I've talked to my father about it, and he agrees that we're just not using systems that are anywhere near sensitive enough to require twisted pairs. Why I do it is because it's a way of, I mean, A, obviously keeping it neat and tidy, but B, it gives you a little bit of extra wire. If I untwist these down the road, if I need more cable length, I can untwist these and gain a little bit of cable length back. So yeah, it's adding a little bit of weight, but it's, weight for a reason, I guess we could say. So now I'm going to do the same thing with this. This is the one that's going to the VTX. We're just going to cut it a little bit long, just so that we have some extra. And then here's our smart audio wire. We're going to run this over. And I did see a couple more questions in orange over there, but I'm trying to balance reading with working. So give me one second here, fellas. And there we go. So now we've got all of our wires at the right lengths, hopefully. Hopefully none of those are too short. Alligator forceps for the win, Frank Nicholas says. Steve-O uses a small blob of hot glue on that antenna right where you were talking about. Yeah, we're going to do some welder later to reinforce some of this stuff. Really good point, Steve-O. Larry says, do you recommend extra flux or is the flux core enough on the new stuff? On a brand new board, on a tiny little pad like this, I will just rely on the flux that's in the core of the solder. So yeah, if it's a bigger board, like the 30 by 30 stuff, I will use a flux pen. If you don't have a flux pen, definitely get one. Or if I come at this a second time, I will use a flux pen. So it's called flux pen for rework, and that's exactly what I was just talking about. If I come back in and I have to redo any of these down the road, I will use the flux pen because it's for reworks, and that's what that's called, is doing a rework. So yeah, flux pens are great to have, and when in doubt, use them. Frank Nicholas says, that's not how my solder suckers work. It's just suction, and the tip is already against the board. Well, Frank, you need to send me a link to what your solder sucker is, because I've had three of them, and they've all had moving pistons in them. If there's a moving piston, it's gonna push down, like, period. Even if you don't feel it, or even if so the piston is gonna start moving down, so technically the body of the pump is gonna move up, but then because you're pushing it down into the board, you're then gonna push it down again into the board. And that's what my dad says is, yeah, I mean, you never ever wanna push on one of these pads, if you can help it, while they're hot, because that's when the pad lifting can begin. So now we've got to strip these. Another trick he taught me is to use your fingernails. Your fingernails are made of keratin, and keratin, by its very nature, will not nick metal wires. And with these tiny little 30 gauge wires, the individual little strands in there, there aren't many of them. So if you nick one of those strands and it breaks off, you've potentially lost, like, let's say if there's 10 strands in there, you just lost 10% of your conductivity. So don't do that. Use your fingernails. And it sometimes helps to grunt when you do this. I'm trying to keep my wire stripping grunting under control. I used to do it all the time, and kind of got a little bit much, but yeah, when you're doing this, to make sure that you pinch it hard enough, it's good to just kind of give it a little whoop. Just put a little English on it, right? Oh, see what I did there? English? Like the language? Didn't even know I was doing it. I was making a bad dad joke, and I didn't even know I was doing it. Is that a sign that 39 is officially too old? All right, here we go. And let's just strip a little bit more here. We got two left. All right, got that one good. And if you don't pull quite enough of the silicone off, just use your fingernail and you can kind of push the silicone down a little bit, and you can usually get yourself a little bit more of the exposed wire there without having to come back in. And it's harder to do the second time. That's what she said. All right, one more here and we will be good to go. All right, looking good. So now what we're gonna do is tin these. Don't ever, ever, ever try to, I know you're gonna be excited at this point to get these soldered to the board, but you gotta wait. You have to tin your wires. It's very, very important. They just will not stick anywhere near as good to the pads if you don't tin them, and not tinning them is a really good way to get some cold solder joints going, which you do not want. All right. So here we go here. And all right, so I'm trying to basically move these in a way that I can do all five of them consecutively, just back to back to back to back. Frank says they do have moving pistons, but you cock them by pushing the piston down. The release makes the piston go up away from the board. So the ones that I've had, I've always pulled the pistons up. But like I was saying, it actually doesn't matter whether the piston goes up or down. You're still like holding it against the board, and when that piston moves, in my experience and in my father's experience, so you know, just I'm not saying I'm right, but I'm just saying in my experience, the tip of the solder sucker always ends up hitting the pad and the board, and I really don't like that. The solder wick, in my experience, is all you need to remove solder. I've never had a circumstance in 3+ years of doing this that I've found myself wanting, other than when I've used one. I've never found myself wanting for a solder sucker because the wick just wasn't working. The wick has always worked well, and I think it's pretty safe to say that the wick is always going to be safer because again, you don't have a big piece of plastic pushing up against the board. But what do I know? You know, I'm just a guy that's been building quads for 3 years. You know, my dad's got a little bit more experience than me, and he's worked on some pretty fancy shit in his life, but you know, to each their own. If you guys have been having good luck with solder suckers and you haven't lifted any pads, then yeah, maybe it works good for you. I personally have not had a good experience with that, with them, and I stay away from them. So maybe don't throw them away. Just, you know, take what I'm saying with a grain of salt. And next time you have a lifted pad, think back and try to think if you maybe used a solder sucker on that pad in the past. And I just want to pull a little bit of the silicone down off of this wire gun to the VTX. So there we go. We're all tinned up. The process of tinning a wire is basically just putting the wire in between the tip of your soldering iron and the solder itself. So if this is the tip of my soldering iron, I'm going to touch the soldering iron to the bottom or just the opposite side of the wire to start transferring heat. And then I'm going to add solder from the opposite side. And the idea is you're trying to get solder in between all of the strands of wire. That's why you want the tip of the soldering iron on one side and you want to push the solder from the other side. And you want to get as much solder up in there on that in those strands of the wire so that when you then put that against a pad that you've tinned, all of the solder flows together and it makes a nice little, hopefully convex, but it is incredibly difficult to get these tiny little solder joints to be convex. Typically, I'm happy if I can get them to the point where they're just nice and shiny and nice and smooth. Getting them convex is really difficult. Kaiser, I would, but he's 70 plus years old and he lives 800 miles away. So it's tough to get him on, but you never know, man. You never effing know. All right, so taking a quick look at my wiring diagram. So these pads are really small. This is going to be a challenging solder job, but we can do it. Just remember, and if you need some if you need any encouragement, just remember, guys. Just remember. 思ってるのって。あともうちょっとのところなんだから。俺だってこの前の10度のところ縮みが取れるって頑張ってんだよ。絶対っていうの。必ず目標達成できる。だからこそ。All right, just remember, this isn't Asiatic clams here. It's not negative 10 degrees. We can do this. We can do this. All right. Just needed to get a quick drink of water there. Appreciate you guys playing along. So up top is smart audio. All right, so since these pads are so close together, we want to think before we just go ham with the soldering iron about the order that we're gonna do these in. One of the things that you're gonna run into when you're soldering tiny little stuff is that eventually the tip of the soldering iron is actually gonna get in the way of the next joint or the last joint that you did. So, here's one thing that you can do. If you're a little bit more of a novice solderer and you have this AIO board, these are through pads, so you could absolutely do every other top versus bottom. So you could do I would actually do this first one on the top here, and then this next one you could do it on the bottom, and then the next one up you could do on the top, the next one on the bottom, and then the last one up here on the top. Absolutely no problem doing that, but we're gonna try to do them all on the top and see how that goes. So let's get that started. Something to take a look at before you go at it on these tiny little pads. Look at the tinned ends of your wires and make sure that none of them have like flattened out and have become wide. You wanna make sure that they're all nice and sharp. Just because any little thing is going to make these try to bridge next to one another. So keep that in mind. I'm thinking about pulling this out of the mount. Yeah, I'm going to take this out of the mount just so that it's a little bit easier to work with. All right, so there we go. Get that mount aside. So now we've just got the board to work with. And the board kind of sits like that, so all right. First one that I'm gonna do is gonna be smart audio, and I am gonna face it outwards because it has to kind of loop up and around the board. So, especially when you're doing tiny little stuff, it's all about the prep. You want to get all the other stuff out of the way so that you're just working with that one. And basically, you need to have this exactly where you want it, and everything needs to be happy before you come in with that soldering iron. If you're trying to fix where the board is sitting or fix where the wire is sitting with the soldering iron in your hand, you're going to have a bad time. So right now, I've just set this up so that this wire is already perfectly on the pad. So in theory, I could just bring the soldering iron in and push this down to the pad, and it would you know, connect itself and be fine. But what you want to remember is this wire is sitting up. So if I come in with the soldering iron and push this down, it's going to liquefy. But then as soon as I remove the soldering iron, it's going to try to pick itself back up. So that's why, realistically, the hand that you have the soldering iron on, all that should be doing is providing heat. It shouldn't be controlling the wire at all, because the wire has a mind of its own. You need to have a set of really sharp tweezers in here to control the actual wire. So that's what I'm going to do now. I'm going to grab it just barely with the tip of the wire, with the tip of the tweezers. I'm going to hold it, and I'm actually going to push it down ever so slightly into the pad, because I want this whole thing to be flat. Now, ready? This is going to happen quick. 3, 2, 1. And there it is. And that's all there is to it. That went pretty smoothly. And it was on top of the picture-in-picture. That's not gone well. Let's move our picture-in-picture up on the top left. Luckily, we've got 5 more to do. Eric Allen calling out, your head is blocking your work. All right, and we're also going to get the... Oh, it is zoomed in. Okay, so I am zoomed in to the max already. I am going to leave it on autofocus because I don't know how I'm going to be moving this around. All right, so now next, our next pad is the camera pad. So there's 2 pads. One of them is called camera, and the other one's called VTX. The camera pad connects to the yellow camera wire. The VTX pad connects to the yellow VTX wire. Nice and simple. So we can see right here, this is our wire coming out of the camera. So we're gonna grab that little fellow. Let's see how we can kind of move this around to get that into a good spot. So I think I'm gonna put the camera like this. One of the real secrets of soldering is it's all about prep. You should spend 10 times as much time screwing around like I am right now, getting this wire into a location that it's kind of happy, as much than with the soldering iron in your hand. You know what I'm also going to do? I'm just going to spin these a little bit just to kind of... I don't need all this extra slack on these 2 wires going from the VTX to the camera, so I'm just going to give them a little tiny twist here, just to kind of keep them together and just make this a little bit neat and tidier. A little bit more neat and tidy, I should say. All right, so that's good. And just keep going. This can get very frustrating, but it's going to be more frustrating if you screw up the joint. So just stick with it. Get this to the point where the wire has enough length, and you can easily grab it with the tweezers, drop it down, and hold it on the pad. And that's exactly what we've done here. So we're good to go. I am going to point this one outwards as well, because it needs to go out to clear the VTX and then forward. So we're going to solder this one down pointing out. And again, still moving stuff around. Soldering iron is in my hand, but I'm not putting heat anywhere. Now I'm going to use my left ring finger to kind of push the board down. You can also get Thumbtack, the blue sticky tack that you used to put posters up on your wall with when you were a kid. If you get that, you can push this whole board into it and it'll stick to the board. What I don't like about the Thumbtack is that it melts from the heat and it just gets all disgusting. Plus, I've done this for long enough where I can just kind of cheat it and do stuff like using my left index finger to hold the board down. Also kind of prepares you for if you ever have to do this in the field, where you probably won't have your Thumbtack, although you could just go out to a grocery store and buy some. All right, so that, again, happened really fast, and the wire is sitting down pretty good, but it could sit down a little bit better, so let's just really quick hit it one more time, and I'm just going to push down a little bit more on the wire. Give it a second. to transfer the heat. And I don't think it flowed on that one. I'm going to use the sharp part of the iron. There we go. That's better. So you saw it as soon as it went liquid, that's when it moved. And then I used the tweezers to put it in the right spot. And now we have a nice clean joint there. And neither one of these have bridged to one another. So we're doing well. Let me just look at this really quickly off camera. Yep, we're good to go. There's a little bit more solder up here on the smart audio wire than I would want, but I just checked it with a little 5X loop, which you should all have. This is one of the more important tools in your arsenal. Link down below in the description to a 5X loop, L-O-U-P-E is how it's spelled on Amazon, as well as most of the other tools that I'm using. Links down below in the description to the majority of these tools on Amazon. Next pad is 5 volts, and now we're gonna send the VTX some power. And same kind of deal, spend a bunch of time moving these wires around so that they're happy and are not going to betray you. Because when a wire betrays you, it is unlike any other betrayal in your life. Including that ex-girlfriend that just tore your heart out. So the exposed bit on this is a little too long, so I'm just going to nip a little bit of it off here. Just taking a little tiny bit of the exposed wire off. When you do that, be very careful of that little conductive bit that you took off. Don't let that fall into the board and short two things that don't want to be connected. So now, let's just get these wires into a good place. Alright, so that's pretty good. Number 3, coming up. Please update the video description with links to what you're building, Frank Nicholas says. Thanks for the reminder, I shall. Euro is here, do you happen to know what is the connector that comes in the Whoop Nano cams? Is it a 3-pin JST 1.25 millimeter? You know, I am a dummy when it comes to the names of those JSTs. Like, there's so many different kinds of JSTs, I actually don't know the names all that well. So I don't know. And the only nano camera that I've bought thus far has been the Phoenix. And that's got a completely proprietary connector that I've never even seen before. So, unfortunately, I am not much of a help. All right, guys, here comes some extra light so that hopefully you can see this one even better than the last two. Holding the wire in the right spot over the solder blob, and we're just going to apply heat. Wait for it to melt and flow. All right, so it did not flow. We're gonna just put a little bit of fresh solder on the tip of the iron. Just a tiny little bit. And so you see how the solder is not melting on the tip? That means that the tip is oxidized right now. So you just need to clean it. So you should have a little sponge and maybe even a little steel wool pad thing. Put it in there and boom. That knocks all the oxidation off of it and you're good to go. Oh man, that's another pretty one. We're getting some pretty solder joints up in here, boys and girls. And again, I'm soldering it outwards because I'm just gonna end up bending these around. And now the ground is pretty much always right next to the 5 volt, so I'm not even gonna look over there at the wiring diagram because I already know what the next pad is. And there we go. Patience is key. We've still got a little bit of solder on the tip of the iron. We're going to bring that down. Now the ground pads are always harder. The ground pads are jacked into an entire layer of the PCB. So as soon as you put heat onto any ground pad, it spreads that heat out throughout the entire board. So don't get frustrated when ground pads are a pain in the ass. They're always going to be like that. You can either turn the temperature up on your iron or just be patient and just give it another second or half second and you'll be good to go. So now we only have this last wire left, but we've got a bunch of wires that are kind of like intertwined with one another. So I want to figure out what the best way to run that wire is. So in order to do that, I'm going to like test fit the VTX in the orientation that it's sort of going to be in once we're done, which is, so I'm glad I did this because my inclination was to go the other way and I think that would have been wrong. So let's get this out of the way. So basically this VTX is going to sit here like this. So it's going to sit like that. So just going to take a look at how these cables are sort of running here. Camera, we don't have to worry too much about. That's going to be out of the way. Camera's going to be up there like that. Power's going to be over there like that. So this is going to be sitting back here. Actually, I think it's actually going to be sitting over here like that. Yeah, it's okay. Let's just get this last one. Let's figure out this last wire, and then we'll screw around more with this. Okay, so... Wow, I cut these guys... I cut them a little bit longer than I thought I would have needed, but it looks like I just barely got them long enough. I got kind of lucky there. I could have very easily cut these too short. Okay, so there we go. So that's how the VTX is going to sit. So I want this yellow right here. So now I'm just going to move that out of the way. Don't let the yellow cross any of the other ones. Pull the yellow one out. And this is the VTX wire. This is the signal going from the board with the OSD added in to the VTX. So I'm just going to move the work around a little bit and grab it nice by the tip there. Put the wire down on the pad. Bring our soldering iron in. Put a tiny little bit of solder on there. If you can see smoke, that's a good thing. That's the flux burning off. And we're just going to bloop. And just drop that guy on there. And that's all there is to it. It's all the soldering that you need to do. I know that looks very easy, but it is not. When you're learning to solder, it's not just you. It's hard. It's really hard. I learned to solder on micros and almost quit the hobby a bunch of times just because I kept doing stuff wrong and blowing stuff up. I also do like to just kind of shorten the leads sticking out from these... from this battery connector, just because I'm gonna have the VTX right on top. And again, keep control of the little bit that you're cutting off because that is conductive and it loves to jump into the board and connect things that should not be connected. So there we go, there's the VTX. That's all the soldering that we need to do. Everything else is just gonna be screwing in screws and plugging in plugs and things like that. So let's get this back in the little mount. One of the things that I really like that Tiny Whoop does with these mounts is they have all different up tilts. You can get 0 degree, 10 degree, 20 degree, well, maybe not zero, but I know you can get 10, 20, and 30 degree up tilt, which I really like. I prefer to have Tiny Whoops at 30 degree up tilt because it gets the ducts out of view. And it's also the same up tilt that I fly on every other rig. So yeah, just kind of having all the up tilts the same for me helps me out quite a bit. Let me zoom this out. We don't really need to be so zoomed in anymore. Now that we're done with the soldering. All right, so here we go. Just going to, and hopefully I didn't cut these too short. I'll be honest, I'm very worried right now that I cut the smart audio wire a little bit too short. We're gonna see in 1 second. And if I did cut it too short, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna just change the angle of it. Well, I mean, if we have to go down that road, we will. And I'm starting to think that we're gonna have to go down that road because this doesn't wanna quite make this angle. What's interesting is that I cut it the same length as the video wire, And the video wire seems fine. So, damn. As soon as I cut that wire, I was like, I hope. Okay, so let's do this. We're going to try to cheat it by changing the angle that wire is soldered to the pad at. So let's come in here. We're going to desolder it. And then we're going to bring it straight down onto that pad. Okay. Let's see here. So, and this might not work. Fair warning. This is a shot in the dark. If we have to, we will take this wire off of the... So you guys aren't going to be able to see this, but I'm just going to do it really quickly here. Worst case, we just desolder this wire from the VTX, plop a new one on there, cut it to the correct length, and all will be right with the world. So here we go. I'm going to bring this guy straight down onto this pad, and that will, for sure, give us a little bit more length. So I'm just getting the pad hot, getting the wire hot, and then we're going to combine them. One second here, folks. Okay, let me use the side of the tip of the soldering iron. This pad is incredibly close to the OSD chip. So be careful. All right, so the tip of the iron is completely oxidized. So let's clean it, and then we'll come back in. Basically, as soon as you're done cleaning the tip of the soldering iron, it starts to oxidize. It happens like instantaneously. So if it's been like 30 seconds since you cleaned it, it's already oxidized. Okay, so there we go. That bought us a little tiny bit more. Let's see if that was enough. And I don't think it was, but let's just keep trying. So if I pull this over here like this and then try to rotate it, nah, still not quite long enough. Well, that's a stupid mistake, but it's a mistake that everybody's made. So, let's desolder this from the VTX, and we will put a new white wire on there. I think I have one sitting right here, actually. And then we'll be good to go. Okay, so the mount is off of it again. So they put this liquid electric tape. I just peel this stuff off of my fingernails, usually. Sometimes it comes off really clean, sometimes it doesn't. You can kind of just get it started with your fingernail and then just kind of pinch at it. Sometimes you come in there with a really fine tweezer. Just if you come in with the tweezers like this, just be really careful because these sharp tweezers will stab right through the insulation. Kind of glad that we made this mistake because this will happen to all of you guys at some point or another. And yeah, just knowing that you A, can fix it, right? You don't have to buy a whole new camera or VTX or whatever. And then B, having some idea how to fix it could save you. Come in here with these guys. Just grab that liquid electric tape and pull it away. All right, almost there. And you just gotta be patient. You just kinda like nibble away at it. Just little nibbles each time. And like I said, sometimes it'll come right off. Sometimes you gotta put a little bit more time into it. But just be patient, because this is... I mean, you don't really care about the wire. I could totally just cut this wire, but you wanna try to get this liquid electric tape off in the biggest chunk possible. So that you can get all of it off of this pad. All right, let's try, and just try different tweezers, try different methods. Use your fingernail, just troubleshoot it. Don't just do the same thing over and over again. If you're doing something that's not working, stop, take a breath, think about it for a second, and come back to it and try something different. There we go. Almost got it all off. And just get this last little bit here that's kind of in between. Okay, so that should be good enough. Since they're using the through holes, that smart audio comes right through the bottom. So we're going to heat the bottom up and we're going to pull it out of the top. And here is a really slick way of doing that. I actually learned this from Tommy way back when. Oh my god. Another one of the things down below are these spring-loaded tweezers. All right. I don't know why I have a piece of painter's tape on there. So here's what you can do. You can clip this to the wire that's on the bottom and use this to pull on that wire. So it's going to be hard for me to show you guys this, but that is currently pulling down on that wire, right? So all I need to do is heat up this joint, and it should just fall right out. So be nice and careful. All right. Let's clean off the oxidation. Tin it just a little bit. And let's see if it works. It's going. It's going slowly. Come on. Get out of there. Come on, little fella. I see you. It's trying. Now, if I wasn't on camera, I would just lift this up. Well, you know what? I'm going to have to. And there it goes. I just pulled it right out. See it? Hope you saw it, because I can't do it again. Whit Coburn with a $5 super chat. Thank you, Whit. For anybody that doesn't know, super chats are all going towards the decased, not deceased, the decased GoPro fund. All the super chats add to that. So we're going to crank that up to 20 bucks. Thank you, Whit. Very kind of you. All right, there we go. We are a tenth of the way there. Look at us go. All right, cool. So let's pop this off of the board, and we will make a wire that is still white, but a little bit shorter. And there we go. Okay, so that pad is now free. The amount of white that I cut off of the wire is more than what was on it. So we can just take these, line these up here, and then we don't need a lot more, but let's go like right there. That'll definitely be enough. There's no way that that'll be too short. One of the reasons why I try to cut stuff relatively short is that wires are heavy, and believe it or not, if you have a build with like a whole bunch of extra wire all wrapped up and you know, doing like loops in there, not only is it bad for video noise, but it's literally heavy. I've had rigs where I've been able to take like 5-6 grams out from just wire. So yeah, never underestimate how heavy wire is. It's metal in there, right? Big long battery leads, they can be like 10 grams. All right. So again, see how the solder won't melt? It's because this tip is oxidized. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 little pokes into the steel wool, and it's still oxidized. A little sponge hit, and it's no longer oxidized. There we go. The little steel wool pads are great, but a wet sponge is the way to go, man. Wet sponges are full of wind. And I'm just gonna re-tin this side of the wire as well, because typically manufacturers use lead-free solder so that all their employees don't die, and lead-free solder doesn't work as good as leaded solder. And only soldering every so often, as we do, we don't really have to worry about the tiny little amount of lead that's in leaded solder. Okay, so this is going to be hard. Let me zoom you guys in. because I want to use the through hole here, if possible. Oops,
there we go.
Okay, so I am going to try to put this, I am going to try to use the through hole in the VTX, so here goes nothing. Take this little guy, make sure I have it firmly in the little tweezers. Don't squeeze too hard with these tweezers, though, because they will chop right through the insulation. And that happened real fast, but basically what I did is I put heat. So if you're going to use the through holes, you want to put the board in a way that you can bring heat in on the back, and that heat is going to liquefy all the solder that goes through the through hole. And then you want to be able to see the front, because you're going to push the little the stripped and tin end of the solder directly in there. So yeah, I usually will try to get it at like a 45 degree angle like this, so that I've got enough room to just bring the tip of the soldering iron in with a little blob of solder on it. And then you'll see on the front, you'll see the solder start to bubble and flow. And that's when you know you can stick your wire in there and then just let go of everything. And you've got through, if you could use a through hole, use a through hole. It's always going to be the most, strong possible method of mounting a wire to a PCB. Just keep in mind the direction that the wire is going to go. If you're using the through hole and then you have to bend the wire at like a hard 90, might not be the best setup. If you're using a through hole, just make sure that the wire is going to be able to go somewhat upwards, so that you don't have to fold it and flex it. And you can very easily break these wires right after where the solder is. And I mean, at that point, it did you no good to take that extra time. So, all right, we're in a good spot here. This looks much better. So I'm going to run this. And again, I'm just figuring out how I want to run this wire. And it's just basically going to be, it's just going to go straight to it. I don't have to do anything crazy here. So let's get this over to the side. And now this is going to be harder to solder because the other ones are going to be in my way, but I can still get it here. It's kind of just come off to the side and get this stuff out of the way. Make sure the board is going to sit flat. All right. And then we're going to come in here and now I want to grab it like this. So I want to grab it like that, and then I can rotate around because I do want this facing outward. So there we go. That's not too bad. Let's get that tacked down there. All right. Wire is on top of the pad. Wire is tinned. And let's bring in our heat. And that's it. That's all there is to it. Whole thing flows, give it a split second, and then remove the heat. And you do want to hold the wire still. Your left hand is going to stay still for a split second as the heat is removed, to give the solder a chance to cool. The worst thing you can do is move it all around when it's trying to cool. It wants to cool stationary so that you don't get what's called a cold solder joint. If you're moving it all around as it's cooling, the solder doesn't cool at the same rate. It cools kind of like from the area farthest away from the heat to the area closest to the heat. So yeah, pay attention to that. That is important. Okay, so in theory, hopefully, we've now got enough room on that wire to have a nice tight little bundle here. Let's take a look. So we got our camera in the mount first, and then we're just gonna swing this VTX around and put it in the mount as well. And there we are. And now we're going to just kind of rotate this guy around here, and let's see if we've got enough. Oh, hell. How did I go around the outside? How did that happen? Well, that's not what I wanted. Really? Jeez. It's not just you guys. Building is hard. Building is hard. Okay. Let's do it without untwisting the whole thing this time. How on earth did that happen? Whew! Man. I've probably built 100 rigs at this point, and they still mess with me, so nobody ever feel bad about not getting this shit right. It is hard. It is hard to build. Building's hard. That's why a lot of people don't want to build and just buy pre-built stuff. Let's do this. I'm actually going to run this to the side here. Just to kind of make sure that we absolutely have enough distance. All right, no big deal. Apply heat. A second. And there we go. Now we're good. Jeez. Okay, so there we go. Take this guy and just kind of rotate it around a little bit. You know what I didn't think about is this button is here. The button is an extra little bit of height, and I bet you that's why that smart audio wire was too short. So now the video wire might be too short, but I don't think it is because it seems able to kind of tuck into the side there. What's going on with this smart audio wire? So maybe I shouldn't have pushed it outwards like that. Or maybe the VTX just isn't snapped into the mount. Hey, there we go. That helps things. Yeah, I'm still running out of cable somewhere. It's the smart audio wire again. It's because it's going backwards around the button. All right, one more time. One more time. I'm going to run it forwards this time, and we're going to be fine. On off of there. This is just part of the game, guys. This is FPV sometimes. When in doubt, do the same thing a dozen times. Am I right? You guys know what I mean. NYX says, have you seen the FPV Cycle 1S board Bob's working on? I have. And it's exciting. Okay, so this time I'm going to go up this way to avoid the button. That's what I should have done in the first place. I'm going to go under this video wire. And then I'm going to go up here. This is why it's good to, plan. Which I did a little bit of, but apparently not enough. Okay, so now I think we're gonna be good. And this is gonna be the tightest yet, but we're gonna be fine. I have faith. I have blind faith in us. Okay. So I'm just gonna drop this down real quick. You guys have seen me do this 3 times. That's plenty. I'm just gonna tack this on and we're gonna move on. Done! Okay. It looked like the other 2 times that I did it. The solder liquefied. I took the heat away. All right, so there we go. So that's better. We've got the power wires here. Let me just get a little bit of... just pulling these power wires a little bit. All right. And now... sure that everything is gonna go, and now the wire that's too short is the VTX wire, but it's not too short. Why is it? Oh boy. Oh boy. What Not to Do by Ciotti FPV. All right, so I see what's going on. It's like notching itself in to this little area here. So what I'm gonna do is run it the other way. Yeah. I'm gonna rotate the direction of it by 180 degrees. All right. This is also a very common thing when it's your first time working on a board. This is one of the big reasons that I suggest that you try to find a setup that works for you and just build multiples of it. Because the second time you do this to a board, it's like a joke. Everything flies so fast and it's just simple and easy. And whereas the first time you can run into all kinds of silly little problems like this. But it doesn't take that much time, man. It's good to do it right the first time. It's the other thing about cutting the wires really short is, like, it keeps you from kind of just going like, ah, nah, it's fine. There's a whole bunch of extra cable, but nah, it's fine. These things fly. Try your best to get them as good as you can from the jump, and they will either fly better or at least they won't fall out of the air as often. June Loco says, is there a whoop smoke stopper out there? I don't think so. I've never seen one. All right. And one quick thing I want to do. There's a little Hershey Kiss looking guy on this, and I just want to cut that off. So maybe, just maybe, we've got it now. I'll move this video outwire to the side here. That's what I was just doing. I was making it so it can go in there the other way. And oh yeah, that's better. Oh, that's better. Yep. Okay. So now let's see. And there we go. The mounting holes will now line up. Look at that. Camera is all fakakta. Let's fix that. Okay. Great. So now I'm just going to push it back a little bit farther just to see, yeah, and see how I have a little bit of extra room when I push it backwards. That's what you want. All right, so since we're soldering, let's do the antenna. Now's a good time as any. So let's get this out of the way because the first thing we need to do is prep it. But you know what I'm also going to do is I'm going to put it in the frame. I want to see how short that I can cut this. This UFL wire is heavy as well. Where'd the frame go? Did I knock the frame on the floor and not know it? I doubt it. Where is it? What? I pushed everything to the side, and it's all right here. Oh, there it is. Okay. So let's just rough fit this in here. So this is going to be somewhere around there. And then this guy is going to line up there. And the canopy is going to be like that. Okay, so basically, sorry guys, I want the head of the antenna like right here, like basically right on top of this guy. So that shouldn't be a problem. The end of the canopy ends right there. Oh wow, it's gonna be really short. Holy cow, is that gonna be short. Yeah, we can let it hang out a little bit. We can even maybe let it kind of tuck in down here a little bit. That kind of looks nice, right? Let's do that. We'll run it and let it tuck in there, and that way it's never have to even think about it getting up in the props. Okay, so if I hold it like this, I'm just going to chop it up here a little bit. And we're going to cut all the way through first. That's the first thing we do, is cut all the way through. Now, next. So there's a pinpoint, and then there's a big flat piece. All right, remember that. That's what we need. So what we're going to do is first, we want to get at the little pinpoint. And to do that, let's round this out as much as we can from where we cut it, because when you cut it, it kind of crimps it. And then we're going to come back in with the cutters, the sharpest cutters you've got. And you're just going to like do a tiny little bit, just a little bit, just cut. And you're not going all the way through. You're just kind of going on the outside and squashing down. You're squashing some beef. Squashed beef. All right? Because what you're trying to do is take off the outside rubber, and then you're trying to go through. Well, actually, right now, all we're trying to do is cut off the outside rubber, come to think of it. It's been a while since I did this, so forgive me for being a little bit out of order. Sebastian asks, what motor size? These are 0802, 22,000 kV. All right, so I didn't cut all the way through the outer sheath, so we'll come back in and just gentle. All right, I think I just got it. I think it actually just kind of came off on its own. Nah, it's still hanging on, but it's coming off. And there it goes. Okay, so there's that outside rubber. So now what we've exposed is the kind of copper-ish in color braid. And here's the other thing you can do is take an X-Acto knife and just run an X-Acto knife around there to make sure that you got all the rubber, because you got to make sure that you get all that rubber off of there. All right? So, now, that outer rubber layer, and you'll see it'll get more shiny. There we go. So now it's more shiny because there's no rubber on the outside. And we're just going to rotate it around, and yeah, we're good to go. So, now, you're going to use your fingernail, and you're going to pull that braid outwards. And this is going to take a little bit of time, so just, again, patience. Just keep going around. Around. See how it's starting to poke outwards? Once you've pulled all of these outwards, what you're going to notice is there's a kind of whitish plastic sheathing under them. And then inside of that sheathing is a single metal core. These braids that we're pulling out, these are what you're going to connect to the big flat spot on the VTX. And then the single strand of inner core is what you're going to attach to that little pinpoint on the VTX. So I think I pretty much have all these. All right, so now that you've pulled them out like this, believe it or not, you're just going to cut them off. So you just take your little clippers here, and you're just going to cut them flush with the rubber. And this will make more sense in a minute. But yeah, you just come around here and just real carefully. Okay, so there's one little strand that I did not get out of there. So let's get it with the, there we go. And just chop it off. Just go around cutting it off. You won't be able to get all of it off, but you'll be able to get most of it. And that's all we really need. And again, it'll make more sense in 1 second. So just chopping it all off here, and again, this is all conductive, so be careful with it. And now let's just come back in with our fingernail again and pull this stuff out, just in case like the clippers just kind of pushed it down. You just want to get as much of this cut off as you possibly can. Because in a second we're going to expose that inner single strand. And that's hard to do. So the better job you do here, the better that process is going to go. So again, just kind of going around, just chopping some of this braid. And I think that is just about good enough. Oh yeah, we're getting there. We might even be there. Let's see. Okay, so I don't think you guys are gonna be able to see it, but right down the middle, nope, even I can't see it, because when I initially cut it, it kind of pinched the plastic a little bit, which is okay. You don't have to be able to see it, but I'm trying to kind of like illustrate this to you guys as best as I can. Let me just get a little tiny bit of this more, a little bit more of this off rather. And there we are. Okay, so now you can really see that inner plastic sheath, right? Let me give this, yeah, see that? All right, inside of that white plastic is metal, and you need to get to that. So, what we're gonna do, again, super, super careful, not all the way back, but like halfway, we're gonna clip, and we're just gonna give like the tiniest little bit of pressure. All we wanna do is get through that white plastic. That's all we wanna do. So right in the middle of the white plastic, we're just gonna give little tiny chomps. Chomp, 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 just little, real gentle, so, so gentle. What I'm actually trying to do is just leave a little groove, because then I can come in with my fingernails and rip the plastic off. All right, so let's see how I did. So you see how I left a little groove in there? If I put it over the black. See that? See the little groove that I left right before it went out of focus? I'm going to put my fingernails in that groove, and I'm going to pinch as hard as I possibly can with my fingernails, because you want to get this right on the first shot. So pinch, pinch, pinch with your fingernails, and you guessed it, pull. And I'm going to give it a real grunt this time. And I fucked up. Okay, so I didn't get it enough, and I pulled the plastic out. So now it's not the end of the world, it just became a little bit harder. We gotta do the same thing again. Come in here, and we're just gonna, real gentle, just chomp, 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 all the way around, chomp, 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 chompy, 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 chompy. And let's try it again. Pinch like hell, and crap. All right, so at this point I can see the metal in there, so I can kind of use the cutters to pull. Yeah, so this is where this is the hardest part for sure. Because if you go too far, you've got like 5 strands of wire in there. So it's like impossibly easy to chop through them, and if you chop through them you have to do this all over again. So now I'm just going to try using the X-Acto knife to see if I can put a little bit of a better groove in there. And now I'm actually going to see if I can use these to pull it, and there it is. Okay, got it. So I'm going to manually focus this because this is the most important part. All right. That is, that's infinity focus. I want macro focus. All right, so now you guys, I think you guys should be able to see everything that's going on in here. So let me just hold this up. All right, so you've got the braid, you've got the rubber on the very outside, then you've got the braid, then you've got the little inner white plastic, and then you've got the very inner center metal core. All right, and on our VTX, the little tiny center core needs to go to that little tiny circle, and then the braid needs to go to this big flat area here. All right, so back into it, because we got to clean this up. It's a little messy. I'm actually going to cut a little bit more of this braid off. Oh, let me fix the... put it back to autofocus for you guys. There we go. Well, that's a good idea, Tiago. Nail clipper. It's a really good idea. All right, so let's just clean up a little bit more of this braid around the outside. And basically, we want to make sure that no solder can connect the braid to the inner part, right? Because, I mean, what's the point of soldering things in 2 different places if they're just going to connect via the solder, right? So yeah, we just want to really make sure that none of this braid, there's not like a single stray is the word I was looking for, strand of the braid that can get too close to that center core. So that's pretty good. The only thing that I'm worried about is I don't know if I have quite enough of the plastic removed from the inner. So I'm actually going to take my little 5X loop and do this off camera just because the size of this inner part is kind of ridiculously small. And I'm just going to take my X-Acto knife and just try to get a little bit more of that center plastic away, because I want to make sure that I have enough of that center strand that's in the middle available for that pad. So I'm just really gently, just with the X-Acto knife, just taking a little bit of that plastic off, just a little bit, and we're almost there. Almost there. There it is. That was the last piece that I needed to come off. And it's still stuck to it, but I bet you if I just use my fingers. There we go. Alright, so that's what I wanted. So now we're not done. This is like the job that never ends. Hold on one second here. All right, bear with me, and I heard a Facebook message, and sometimes that's somebody telling me that I lost video or audio or something like that. No, it was just random. All right, so next, all of that outer braid needs to connect, right, to that big fat part of the VTX. So the last thing that you need to do is to cut a little more of this outer insulation off so that we have access to some of these strands, right? We cut them all short. So we need to get just that outer layer, just a tiny little bit of that outer insulation off here, just like we did initially. You know, this is the first thing that we did, just again. And just really lightly, just trying to leave like a little indentation, not trying to cut through any of that braid. So just be nice and gentle. Work it around, work it around, work it around. And then fingernails. See if you can pull it off. And this is where I really like to use the X-Acto knife, because it's nice and sharp, and it'll just, you can just kind of roll it in your hand, and it'll usually follow the same path, and it'll just dig right through that rubber, and then you can fingernail it right off usually. And here it comes. And there it is. So now you got that nice shiny part. You're going to solder that down to the big flat rectangle spot, and then you've got your tiny little inner core. So we're going to tin these, and then we're going to put them on the thing. We're going to, do that thing that we've been talking about. Put them on the thing. Here we go. Okay. Let's get some focus going. All right. Get some more light on it. And we're going to tin it just like a regular old wire. We're going to be a little bit careful because we want to make sure that we don't connect the outer braid with the inner braid. But other than that, it's pretty straightforward now. You can just glomp a bunch of solder on here. I think my soldering iron cooled itself off. Yeah, this Weller 1010 soldering iron has a automatic cool down to save the tip, which has saved me a whole bunch of times. I've left this thing on overnight almost more than I've remembered to turn it off. My old soldering iron had a bright red LED on it that would like catch my eye, and this one does not. So we're just going to come in here, and we just want to get solder all the way around. And we're good. And we're going to come up to the inner core. And we're good. Just make absolutely sure. And then we'll hit the braids one more time. And there we go. Now all we got to do is tack it down to the VTX, and our soldering is done. Let's take a quick look at it. Kind of ran off here. Let's just chop that off. Fine. And what we're making sure of is that none of the solder traveled up to the tip, and none of it did. All right, so we're good to go. Last little bit of soldering. And I usually just do this by hand because the it's so short that you can really control it very well here. So, although, you know what we can do is drop this thing down into the frame, which will just kind of make it a little bit easier. So let's get these, gone forever. found it. All right, there we go. Actually, let me see. Can I just kind of push this thing down? Is that going to cooperate? Or is it going to be a jerk? Let's see. Yeah, that'll be fine. That's not moving quite enough to cause issues. So we're going to put the tip down first, the single inner strand down first, and then we're going to come back for the big part. No, you know what? Let's do it the other way. Let's do the big part first, and then that'll kind of plant the single individual center core where it needs to be. So we'll get a little bit of solder on the tip of the iron. Can you guys see what I'm doing? Yeah, just barely. What if I rotate this to the side? I think that'll be better for you guys. Hey, yeah, there we go. That's much better. All right, so watch what happens when the solder flows. You really do want to let the whole thing flow, and then you're going to remove the heat, and it's going to kind of straighten itself out. So little bit of solder on the tip of the iron just so we have some flux there, and we're going to bring the iron down nice and flat. That's going to transfer a ton of heat. So now it's transferring heat into the wire, and now it's starting onto the pad. The whole thing just went liquid, and remove. And that, my friends, is all there is to it for that outer part. And then for the single inner core, I'll take an X-Acto knife just so that I have something to control the wire to push it down, and then it's going to go real quick. Yeah, you guys aren't going to be able to see this, but I'm just using the X-Acto knife to push down, apply heat, and wham. It's just like instantaneous that thing goes. And hopefully you have not bridged any of those, because if you've bridged them, you have to remove it and start all over again. It's almost impossible to unbridge them. Let me take a quick look, and I am good to go. Let me put this on super duper macro, and I'm going to show that to you guys. The solder is not super shiny, but there's a nice big chunk of it, so it should be fine. All right. Let me get this at just the right different distance. There you go. So you can see the center blob there, and then you can see the outer blob. And that's actually going to be nice and strong. This outer blob, you see how it comes up over top, right? It flowed, and it flowed down to the pads on the VTX. Oh, hold on. So it flowed down to the pad, but then it also came up and over. So it's like one big belt hanging, you know, holding the entire UFL on. So there you go. The only way that this could have been better is if I'd been a little bit quicker. I was a little too slow, and that burned off a lot of the flux, and that's why it's not shiny. But what's good about this is it's nice and smooth. As long as it's smooth like this and it's not all craggy and there's not fucking holes in it and all kinds of other nonsense, pardon my French. I've been trying hard not to curse on this stream here. But yeah, as long as it's nice and smooth here, it's totally fine. It doesn't absolutely need to be shiny. We're not sending these things to space. There is a kind of like an acceptable amount of margin that comes with these guys. So now we can finish putting this thing together, pull it into Betaflight, get everything set up, and fly it inside. So grommets are going to go on the AIO first, because if you put them on the frame and then try to do it that way, you're just going to pull all of your hair out. All of it. Not just some of it. All of it. Oh, wait. I can also zoom you guys out. Oh, and put autofocus back on. Hey, look at me go. There you guys are. That should be a whole hell of a lot better. Thanks, Frank. okay, last one is here. And we're just going to go right in there with that guy. All right, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And they're all nicely in their little homes. So now, again, this is the rear with the USB port and the battery cable. So we're going to go, I'm using this as the rear, so I'm going to go in this hole. I just like the way that the power connector routes when you put it through that little hole there. And then we're just going to go onto each little stalk here and gently just kind of work this guy downwards. If you're not gentle, the little rubber grommets will pop off and roll across your desk onto the floor, never to be seen or heard from again. All right. And it's kind of going, just kind of work around each one a little bit. And this board sits down nice and low on this Meteor frame, which is kind of nice. Really low center of gravity. And there we go. There's our little mount is all lined up now as well. The wires are all just barely long enough. This camera is pointing, keeps wanting to point to the side though. And I suspect it's because of this guy. So let's route that guy a little bit different maybe. If we route him around the side. I think I like that idea a little bit better. Well, this power cable is kind of in the way. Yeah, I should have cut these a little bit longer. I was chasing the dragon a little bit when I cut these short to try to really make this as clean as possible. I would not suggest you cut these quite as short as I did. Let's pop this, let me kick the soldering iron back on. I'm going to take this video wire off that's going to the camera, and I'm just going to send it out the side so that it comes around the side and connects. That'll be the easiest way to just kind of take care of this problem real fast here. A lot of rework today, good lord. And I am actually going to lift this up off the board because what I hate doing and what I was doing earlier in my stream is melting the frame. I hate bringing the soldering iron down on the frame and accidentally melting little spots in the frame, mainly just because it looks ugly. It's not really going to affect performance. It's just a vanity thing, I guess, on my part. Okay, so, oh yeah, I should have seen where that sat anyway, and I should have run it out the side from the jump. That was a mistake on my part from the get-go. And I might be able to just hit this and have that wire pop off. Let's see. Yep. Nope, not quite. It did come off, and then it stuck itself right back down. Just come on off of there, little fella. Come on. You know you want to. And whoop. Was that it? Almost. So close. Come on. Get out of there. There it is. Nope, it resoldered itself. Keeps sticking itself back on there. it's better. Now I have better access to it. Okay, there we go. And I can actually use the tip of the soldering iron to push it off this time. There we go. Okay, so now we're good. And what I want to do is just route it to the side. So we're just going to pull it out like that, and we're just going to stick it right in the side there, and then it's going to be, it's going to have plenty of room. So I want it to go in there, and then I can take this. Much harder now that the antenna's on it. But we still have just enough room. Woo, it is close, but we have just enough room to get this guy onto its little pad and to sneak the soldering iron in there. So let's get that done here. I'm not going to bother zooming in because you guys just saw this. And maybe you'll learn something from seeing it zoomed out. Hey, there we go. Okay. So that guy is almost on that pad. I'm going to use the tweezers to just pull it over ever so slightly, and old friend. Sit down on that pad, please. Almost there. All right. There we go. That's that pad. Okay. Usually try not to come at an angle like this, but we'll be all right. And there it is. So we're good. And that even made a half-decent joint, too. A lot of times when you're doing stuff in tight like that, you got to kind of sacrifice the joint looking good for just getting it done. But that joint came out quite nice. So now that wire is going to come off the side. And it should buy us the, like, millimeter extra that we that we were basically looking for there. So, okay. Let's get these grommets back on here. Put it back in the frame one more time, and we should be good. Right. Number two, number three in the back, and number four up front. Not that they have any actual numbers. What's going on in that chat there? June Loco says, did you ever get the B-brain going? I did. That was this morning's stream. If you want to check it out. I forget what I named it, but it's the only other stream from today. All right, one more time for good luck. Here we go. Left side, right side, front. Oops, how'd you come off left side? Get back in there. Tiny Whoops are very fiddly, but luckily they're also very inexpensive and very easy to build. You just got to take a deep breath sometimes. they can be very, very frustrating. Just remember, it's not you, man. It's or woman. It's just the way that it is, man. Building small stuff is a pain. And but luckily. Got some good resources. You've got Mr. Bardwell, you've got me, lots of other really good people building some really cool stuff day in and day out. All right, so that's it. That does it. Now that all lines up, it's not pulling on the camera anymore, and we even have a little bit of wiggle room. Not a lot, but a little. Truthfully, I wish I'd cut all of these wires a little long. When I started cutting the wires, I was like, ooh, boy, you're really going for it today. But, I don't know. Clean builds, man. Neat and tidy. We're going for the ultimate. So, we've really gone ultimate with with the wire length. Okay, so let's put some of these screws in here, front and back. As I'd mentioned earlier, we can do, because they, you know, as it sits like this, because those are not used in the way that this Tiny Whoop pinch camera mounts. So let's do those first. Here's another trick. Don't just hammer these down as far as they'll go. You can leave them a little bit loose and give the AIO board a little bit more leeway to kind of jiggle around. The jiggle is good because if you've got some vibrations coming through the motors, the fact that it's on these rubber grommets can kind of help that. So I'll usually go kind of full tight, and then I'll back it off like a half a turn or so. So that's pretty much full tight, and then just back it off a little bit, just to give it a little bit more squishiness. And now we're going to screw down through our Tiny Whoop mount. So let's get that going here. And we've got one off on the side. And then again, screw it all the way down. Well, with this, you're not going to be able to bury it because of the mount. So I'm just going to go right until it's kind of snug. And now we're going to come over on the other side and do the same. Make sure that these screws that you're using aren't too long, because the bottoms of these are closed. If the screw's too long, it's never going to tighten all the way because it's just going to bottom out on the bottom of the plastic. So there we go. Screw it all the way in and then out a half turn. And then you can just kind of like look at it, just line it up like this, and just look at your screws to see how much they're sticking up. You want to try to get them as even as possible. This one is a little bit buried a little bit more than I want it, so let's just pull that up a little bit, and then we'll screw the other side down a little bit. So there we go. There is the pinch cam on what I believe to be a 20-degree mount. I thought that was a 30-degree mount, but now that I really look at it, I think that's actually a 20. I've got my antenna under here, so I do want to pull that out. I do like to get... This is the receiver antenna. I like to just kind of do that with it. You got to be careful, though. You don't want to get it too close to the video lines, or it can cause some garbage in the video. So when you do this, just kind of look at where your... You know, we got a little space here between this one, and then this video line is over here. We got a nice little distance there. So that should be fine. And then we need to plug our motors in. All right. Beautiful little 0802s with these. I can't wait for one of these to blow up, because I can't wait to see, to pull it apart and look at how ridiculously small these little bearings are in here. It's got to just be hysterically small. I plug these in with the tweezers, because I don't have big fat fumbly fingers, but these connectors make me feel like I have big fat fumbly fingers. And when I do this, I'm not gripping with the tweezers. The tweezers are kind of loose because I want to push down with the plastic. I haven't really had any of these break, but I'm not about to start now. So yeah, just try to push down on the plastic and never, ever, ever tug on these wires, because on everything small, on all the micro stuff, like, it's fiddly for a reason. It's fragile. The micros are still fragile. They're getting better, but you can still so easily overpower these and just rip these things to shreds when you really didn't mean to. Or maybe you did mean to, because you've been building for 6 hours and you're angry. Definitely don't speak from experience there. No way. That would be crazy. So let's plug it in and see what happens. TinyWhoop.com, BT2.0, 333 milliamp, 1S HV. Let's see what goes down. Hey, we've got boop, boop, boop. And then we've got the second set of beeps as well. That's good news. VTX lights are on. We're going to pull power, because I just basically wanted to see if it would power up. And I just realized that I have to take these side ones out, because I forgot to put the canopy on. Yeah. I forgot. I just thought, wait a second, don't put the canopy on until you've tested it, but there's five pads, so I'm pretty sure I got everything on the right pads. I made all of my mistakes in cutting the wires too short. I'm not going to make any mistakes here. Let's go with this canopy. This is a cool looking one. No. This one glows in the dark. I think this one glows in the dark. Yeah, it does. All right, so here's the canopy action. This, admittedly, is going to make screwing this mount on a little bit more difficult. Let's see.
It's 10 o'clock.
My computer just let me know that it's 10 o'clock. This took a lot longer than I thought, mainly because I cut those wires too short. So there you go. If you want to build fast, don't cut your wires too short. Well, now I feel bad. I should have answered License to Drive's question. I thought I'd be able to knock this whole thing out and like half an hour max. Well, that wasn't too bad. I just had to kind of hold it up sideways. It hasn't been 2 hours, has it? It's only been 1 hour, right? Oh my god, it's been 2 hours. Slowest builder in the world here! Alright, there we go. And now keep in mind, this is a prototype canopy. It might not quite be perfect. He was looking for feedback. Ooh, that fits there nice. Look at that. Wow, this canopy fits tight in here. Oh my goodness, look at that. That's pretty nice. I am digging that, and this is nice and solid, and look, it's using that little bit of I'm going to bend it down a little bit. I'm just going to come up in here and put a little kind of downward bend in it just to sort of tuck it down in there. Look at that. That is fancy. Is that camera sitting a little bit sideways? I think it is. Just nudge that camera a little bit. All right. All right. I'm digging it. I'm digging that. Let's see if we can pry this, push this lens up a little bit. Let's see here. Eh, that's all right. I'm going to end up putting the 30-degree up tilt in here anyway. So let's get this plugged into Betaflight. I admittedly am going to blast through the Betaflight settings since you guys can pause. So keep your finger on the pause button because it's about to go fast. I've done Betaflight settings about a million times, and I'm just going to blitz through them for you guys. What's going on in the chat? So I'm pretty sure that I missed a ton of orange messages in the chat. Anyone before Whit Coburn, go ahead and copy and paste. It's from tinywhoop.com, Chris Croft. Go ahead and copy and paste any questions that I may have missed. Okay, so let's come over here and get Betaflight fired up. And we're going to pull up this camera eventually. Nope, that's the wrong one. That's the right one. All right, so here we are with all of our favorite Betaflight. So first and foremost, flatten your rig out and make sure that everything goes the way you would expect it to. Nose down, nose up, left side down, right side down, yaw left, yaw right. Good to go. Gyros are sitting properly. This is also a good time to calibrate the accelerometer, so let's get this sitting somewhat flat. It's actually not too bad. Yeah, it's fine. Close enough. We'll calibrate it with stick whatevers. So it looks like they've got smart audio set already down here on UART 2, so that means UART 1 is going to... Oh, wait, no. It's internal. It's got the internal... whatever it's called. I do run the motors reverse, so I'm going to flip that switch. It looks like 4.1 is on here. I'm going to put this on RPM filters. Yeah, I'm going to put this on RPM filters. So in order to do that, we need to give it power. So let's do that. And then we need to fire up BL Heli. All right, here's BL Heli. We're going to come down. We're going to give it a second. And come on. There it is. Connect. Make this full screen for you guys as well. We're going to read setup. And 16.7. Yeah, so that's not new enough. One of the things I always do is move the beacon delay down to 2 minutes so that after 2 minutes it'll start yelling at you to come find it. And then I turn the beacon strength up so that when that beeper does come on, it's a little bit louder. And then I also turn brake on stop on. I do that as a leftover from 5-inch rigs, but it's just a good thing to do. And then you're going to write setup. Give it a second. All right, writing has finished. We're going to flash all because we want to put newer firmware on there. And the newer firmware we want to put is 16.71. This is the regular old BL Heli available firmware that will... say files unavailable. Okay, so that's an easy fix. OH5. This is what we want to remember. OH5. We're going to come out of here and we're going to go to disconnect. We're going to pull up. I think this old tower of mine is the reason for that. So I'm actually going to do this on my laptop really quick because what I was about to do is download
0.71, but there's a chance that once I do that, it's still not going to work. So let me just try this really quick. The last couple times that I've had that error message, it's just been a driver issue because this is a... I'm streaming from a 13-year-old tower. And this laptop is fast enough to replace that tower, but I need to get off my ass and transfer everything. Which, since I've been using that tower for 13 years, it's got a lot of shit on it. And it's got a lot of shit buried on it. So yeah, I just need to get that transferred. I'm going to do the same exact thing that you just saw me do over here, though. Connect. And I'm going to go to Flash All. Well, no, Read Setup first. And then we're going to go to Flash All. You guys aren't going to be able to see it. It's a moot point. Same thing I did, Flash All, select version 16.71, Flash. File is unavailable. OH5. Okay, back to square one we go. So it wasn't the tower. Good to know. Alright, what did I say? OH5, I think? Let's see if we can find it on GitHub. That's interesting. Yeah, I know, Frank. I don't want to do more things to take more time. I don't want to do more things that'll prevent me from switching over. The last thing that I need is for this tower to work even better, because then I'll just never switch over. So let's search Google for GitHub. Come on, OBS. Don't be like that. GitHub. What was it? OH5BL Heli. Let's see what that finds. June Loco, there are going to be not one. There's going to be not one, not two, but three Ciati FPV stickers available. As of tomorrow, it's going to be a three pack, and they're going to be $10 for the three pack. I got to get some kind of a retail thing set up, but for right now, we're just going to do PayPal, and we'll talk more about that on tomorrow's stream. I'm going to stream tomorrow when the stickers come in, and I'll give you guys my PayPal address. I'll give you guys my PayPal address then. I know I just cut myself off. Okay, so OH3 is what I'm looking for. Here's the BL Heli configurator page, and we just need to find all of the individual hexes, which I think is at this. Hey, there they are. So we're looking for OH3. C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K, L, M, N, O. Where is O? Here we go. Here's O, OH4, OH3. There we go. So we have a choice. We have 24... Here, let me zoom you guys in. We've got the OH3 24-bit. We've got the 48-bit. And now we've got 96, which is just crazy. I'm going to do 48. I'm going to wuss out and do the 48 because that is plenty for me. And I did that wrong. You have to, where did it go? There it is. OH3, I said, right? You have to command-click it, I believe? No. God, it's been a while since I've done this. Is it option-click? We're just going to try them all. Hey, there it is. It's option or alt-click that will actually download the file, which you guys can't see because my big dumb head is in the way. There it is. It downloads it right down there. So you gotta option click, and then it'll download right down there. And we're gonna show it in the Finder. It's in downloads. Okay, so now here's what we do. Back into BL Heli we go. Connect. And I think maybe they took that out to force you to go do that because there is the couple different options. You gonna connect, friend, or you just gonna sit there? Looks like it's just going to sit there. Let's unplug it, power cycle the board, and we will replug it. And a thing just happened that we'll talk about in a minute. Oh, no! Just dropped it. Okay. Connect. Failed to open serial port. All right, let's quit out of BL Heli, and we'll come back in. Oh, what's happening? There we go. Come on, BL Heli, do your thing. Do your thing.
Okay.
Hey, there it is. All I had to do was did you try turning it off and on again? Just remember, guys. I won't make you guys watch the whole thing again. So this is not connecting all of a sudden, which is odd. Let's remove power. Let's take this little guy off of here. I'm going to try to push this. So I pushed up too hard. What I said we were going to talk about in a minute is I pushed up too hard on the board when I was plugging the USB in, and it popped off of the grommet. And sometimes you can just kind of force it back on the grommet, which I'm trying to do now, but it's kind of going on there. Hey, there it goes. Okay. All right. So now let's try this again. USB. And it just popped up and off the grommet again. God damn it. Oh, that's the problem. It's popping up off the grommet, and then the this USB plug that I've got is like big and chunky, and it's hitting the frame, and it's not plugging the USB in all the way. So, okay, if I support the top of the board and the bottom while I plug it in, Okay. So let's take the canopy off. Remember how I was like, nah, we'll be fine. Yeah. Scratch builds always take a long time, man. Always, 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 always. Everything that can go wrong does go wrong, and as often as possible. Alright. Let's just come over here, and I just want to pull this rear screw up. Sorry I'm not showing you guys this. I'm just wanting to get this thing plugged in and flashed right now, to be really honest with you. So now I can get it. There it is. Okay. All right. And now we're going to give it power. And just like magic, OBS's keystrokes no longer work. No, just like magic, now it works. Hey. Okay. Read setup. All the settings are still saved over here. We want to go to flash all, select file manually, and we want to go into downloads, and I'm just going to sort by, I'm going to sort by date added. And there we have it. There's our OH3048. Oh, it's OH5 though. All right, quick. OH5. OH5. You guys are probably telling me that in the chat, but the chat is now like 50 levels below all these windows. Okay, here comes OH5. Back to BL Heli. There we go. OH5, they're both 158K. Open, and hold on. I thought it was supposed to just start after you pick the file. OH5 open. Interesting. Date added. OH5 48 open. flash. File is unavailable. All right. Maybe we're not doing RPM filtering. Let's try this one more. Well, let's try this. Flash firmware, individual. Select file manually. OH5, 48. Could not load local firmware, undefined. What? All right. Let me take a look. See what on earth is going on here. No, Eric, I don't have any room for any extra monitors. I've got three right now. this desk is literally not big enough for a fourth. Okay. Let's think about this for a second. We've got OH5. OH50. Did I miss? Yeah, see, so there isn't... Oh, maybe, I guess maybe there isn't a, so this is OH50 and it's saying no, so maybe there's not a hex file for OH5. I guess OH50 is different than OH5. I just assumed that, you know, there was an extra zero there, but technically speaking, yeah, there is no OH5 in here. It goes from OH0 to OH10. So yeah, maybe we can't run. Let's do this. OH5. Yeah, see, it only finds these, oh. All right, pretend like you didn't see that. Pretend like that didn't happen. Option click on the correct one, zoom back out, and we're back in business. Flash all, select file manually, OH5, open, and could not load local firmware, undefined. well, I'm all out of ideas, I think. Let's try to do it on just the individual one, maybe. Maybe that's got something to do with it. No, it's having a really hard time. Well, let's try one more thing. Did you try turning it off and on again? All right, let's see here. Frank, it's certainly showing up like I'm downloading it. It says that it's 154K, which is the same. Oh, so I can check that because I've done this before. Where is the other? Okay, so let's see how big these are. Well, these are a lot smaller, actually. These are only 17K. Oh, here's one that's 161KB. Yeah, so they appear to be downloading. Let's just try one more time here. Oh, the HTML page. Interesting. Connection failed. Okay. Okay, okay, okay. What do I have that can open this? Nothing! Interesting. I mean, this is the same way that I've always done it. I believe. What's raw mean? Is raw gonna download it? Please download it. Okay. Raw is what I need to option click. Good call, Frank. Good call. $6 for the JESC license, Tiago. Thank you, brother. Okay, so now we should be good. Good call, Frank. Thanks for that, man. The collective hard at work, guys. I'm never the smartest guy in the room, but I'm at least a guy that can wangle McDangle an answer from other people. All right, here we go. All right, so this is getting angry, probably because it's been plugged in for a while. Hell, this battery might even be flat from being plugged in for a while. Where'd the other ones go? Here they are.
Okay. Wangle McDangle, round two. Here we go. This is the comedy of errors that is FPV. This is what I was worried about, doing live stream builds and reviews and stuff. This is exactly what I assumed was going to happen, but that's okay. Hopefully this makes you guys feel a little bit better when it happens to you, because it happens to all of us. All right, Wangle McDangle, come on. Let's get it going. All right. What? Why? What has changed? Nothing. Nothing has changed. Yeah, I mean, I can use JESC, but this worked 14 seconds ago. So out of sheer stubbornness, it's gonna work again, whether it likes it or not. All right. Come on now, BL Heli Configurator. Be working. Okay, here we go. Hey, there it goes. Or not. What? Why? It wouldn't work. Well, all right. So let's try JESC. Well then. I mean, I guess technically I could have bricked it, because I was trying to upload the wrong file, but it wasn't going anywhere. Huh. I guess I blew it up. I guess I won't be sending this video to Beta FPV. Ah, shit sticks. Let's hook it up to the laptop. I mean, it certainly didn't look like it uploaded anything, right? I mean, it just like immediately bombed. Wow. Very strange. Okay. Plugged in. Give it power. And I heard my phone go off, but I think my phone actually blew up today. It just keeps cycling over and over and over again. Ah, there it goes. Okay, so it's the tower. The tower's done that to me before. It does well, but now I don't have the goddamn file over here. All right, hold on. Oh, it fell on the floor. Connect, please connect. Just do it. Just connect. Please. Can you please just connect? It's working. It's fine. You're the problem. Ancient computer. You're the problem. Yeah, right, Chris. All right. I have faith. I can feel it, guys. I can feel it. No. It's not going to connect. Well, while that's faffing about, I guess I'll download GitHub. OH5BLHeli. Yeah, the tower has just completely shit the bed.
Releases, BLHeli configurator, here we go. Laptop has 3% power, so it's gonna die before I can download this. Happy days are here again. If I move all this stuff out of the way quickly enough, I can put it into its little dock, and it will not die. Ooh, it's gonna be close! It's gonna be close! Ooh! Get in your little home! Get in there! Oh my god. Oh, this dock is such a piece of shit! Get in there! Oh, yes. Power. Woo! 2% it got down to. At least it reset the counter, I guess. Okay. OH5. There we go. OH50, OH5. Click, and option on raw. That's the stuff. Okay. BLHeli configurator. Unplug from the jerk of a tower. Oh, man, my audio panels are falling down now. Hurricane hit this place. Okay. Jeez. Unplug, reset the flight controller. Good. Power. Good. Connect on the laptop. Failed to open serial port. Yes! I was hoping for that. Let's try this again. Relaunching BLHeli. Waiting patiently. Clicking connect. Oh my god, it's working. What a treat. This hobby, man. Woo! It is a test of your fortitude. Downloads, and there it is. OH548. Open. There it goes. There are little bars that are filling up. Just pretend like there are little bars that are filling up. It's in a purple screen that looks like this. It's in a purple window that looks like this. Bunch of little bars, they're filling up. Oh, look at that. The second one is halfway done. There it goes. Wow. This is... We've gone off the reservation tonight. The Mask is on Hulu, guys. Go watch The Mask. We were just talking about The Mask the other day in here. Holy cow. Okay. All right. Last ESC is halfway done. Keep going, buddy. Just, you can do it. You can make it. I have faith in you. Keep going. Don't touch it. Nobody touch it. Man, 2.5 hours. Hey! For the love of RPM filtering. That's why we did that. Because it's just that good. It is that good that I'm willing to go through that much work just to put it on a tiny whoop. What do you think about that? Okay, so now the mess has just imploded. Okay, let's just... I just need to move this acrobat off to the side a little bit here. Let me just take this. Okay. All right, good. Good, good, good. Battery is not hooked up. That is completely fine. BLHeli, you're dead to me. Get out of here. And back into Betaflight we go, where I know how to do things. Configuration. Here we go. Bidirectional D-shot. Number of motor poles. That's actually the number of magnets. And I have not counted them on this, so let's do it together. Starting at the B in Beta FPV, we've got 1, 2. Wait, I lost count already. All right, so we're all right, okay, against that wire. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 55, 56, 57, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62, 63, 64, 65, 66, 67, 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, 87, 88, 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, 96, 97, 98, 100, 101, 102, 103, 104, 105, 106, 107, 108, 109, 110, 111, 112, 113, 114, 115, 116, 117, 118, 119, 120, 121, 122, 123, 124
three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13? Really? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. No, 12, 12. Okay, it is 12.
All right, 12 motor poles. Which is pretty normal. Micro motors typically have 12, and then bigger motors will have 14. So we've got 12 there, arming at 180. That means it'll arm if it's upside down. That is what I want. This is, again, you guys can rewind this. So I'm just going to go 7,000 miles an hour through this. It's an F4 board, so the highest we can go is D-Shot 300 with 4K, so we've got that. I clicked this here to reverse the direction of the motors. I'm probably going to have to go back into BL Heli to do that. God damn it. Craft name is going to be my name. Camera angle, always turn this to zero. Always, always, always. If you don't, this is going to mix yaw and roll, and it's going to fly really weird. SPI RX support with FR Sky X, that's the correct one. Telemetry is on. Air mode all the time is off. I like that. I run air mode on a switch. And then D-Shot beacon configuration is both, these are both turned to on. Again, that is what you want. And then these guys are all normal. I think I did make a change or two, so we're going to save and reboot. And let's come back in. All right, I was going to say, has it changed? motor throttle is 4.5. So the reason this is Betaflight 4.1, so we actually don't care about that. 4.2, we would care about that, but in here we don't. Maximum cell voltage is 4.5. That's good because we're going to run high voltage cells. Come in here to PID tuning. First thing I do is change the rates. We're going to go with my super secret. Oh, no, actually, I have different indoor acro rates. I think they're 0.35. I believe that's what I run for acro indoors. And then super rate. Why is there no super rate? That's weird. 0.8. I just basically want to get myself to 700 degrees a second, so it looks like it's 0.9 to get there. 0.88. That should take me there. And then we'll get rid of the expo. No expo for me. I am expo-less. Why is it on rate profile 3? Now that we're on rate profile 1, we can do it again. 0.4. I go a little bit higher on the on yaw, just so that you don't have to move the stick quite as much. Helps me out for whatever reason. Okay, so this is going to be 0.8-ish. No, 0.88. There we go. Okay, that's better. And filter settings, we are going to go, wow, look at these aggressive filter settings right out of the box. We're going to go low and zip. They have this thing like cranked. Oh, the dynamic notch Q is very low though. I'm going to move that up to 250, and then I'm going to move the minimum hertz down to 90. Always, 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 if you're running RPM filtering, make sure you turn this box on and leave this harmonic alone. This harmonic needs to be on 3. That is very, oh, you guys are stuck behind my head. Okay, so I'm glad that I zoomed in. So this is going to be my starting point. This is my typical starting point. Harmonics on 3, never change that in my opinion. Minimum frequency of 100, you can definitely move that up to 200 because the dynamic notch filter is still on. Low, you want 0. The 0 turns it into 2 individual filters into 1. That decreases latency a ton. And then the Q, I always move up to 250 because the dynamic notch filter doesn't do a whole lot, to be honest with you. It's just an extra filter. The RPM filters are doing the majority of the work. And then for the dynamic notch minimum hertz, you know what? I usually move that down to 90, but we really don't need to on a Tiny Whoop. Let's go 100 will be fine. Zoom back out for you guys. And then I'm just going to leave these sliders at 1 point. Nah, we'll go 1.5. Nothing like immediately changing your mind. All right, now we're going to come over to the PIDs, and let's turn the... No, I didn't want to do that. Did it save it? It did not. So this is the tune that they give you. I'm going to leave it. Let's see how their tune... It looks pretty aggressive. Demons are up in the 40s. That's pretty serious. Feed forward, I am going to move down a ton, though. I prefer almost no feed forward. And we're going to put this at 40. Feed forward transition, I always run all the way up at 1. Throttle boost, that's fine. I-term rotation is a line of sight thing. I don't know why they have that turned on. VBAT pit compensation, I do like. I leave that on. I-term relax, 20 is for racing. I don't race. I freestyle, so we drop that down to 10. D-min advance, I move all the way up to 50 because that raises the D-min very quickly. Here's the thing, though. They have the D-max 1 above the D-min, which is too low. We want more of a gap in there. So I'm going to go up to 50 and 52. That at least gives the D a little bit of range to move around. Wow, 25i on yaw. I think they do that to keep it like pulling itself into walls. I'll leave it. Let's see how it is. And that's about it. We'll save it. Receiver. Let's see if this thing is receivering.
Welcome to OpenTX.
Welcome. Oh, it's not bound. All right. So let's get it bound. Move this away from the microphone. Hey, that's what I wanted to hear. I'm assuming that there's a button on here. Hopefully I don't have to jump anything. Oh, please. Please, please, please give me a button. Or wait, no, I can just put, oh, there's a button. Well, let's try this, because Betaflight's getting all fancy. You can do it in the CLI. What do you type into the CLI, guys? I forget. Is it just bind? Do I just type bind in here, I think? Nope. Get bind? Hey! Spectrum sat bind, free sky auto bind on... what's the bind command, guys? Do you remember? There it is. Good looking out. CMYK. So that's the same. Let me just, for my own personal, FR Sky SPA. No, it's not. FR Sky SPA bind hop. Nope, that's not it either. Well, that didn't work. Unknown command. Guess again, chat. Damn right I'm asking you guys. This is the collective at work, yo. You guys are just as smart as I am. Maybe it's without SPI. Let's take the SPI off. Bind underscore RX. There it is. So it's just bind underscore RX. So... where are the LEDs on... There they are. We've got flashing green and flashing red. Maybe that's a good sign. I thought that it would reset the flight controller. Maybe it did. Maybe it's fine. Let's see. Put power to it again. And let's see if we got anything in the receiver tab. Hey, look at that. Now we're talking. All right, so let's put it into tear. save it. And then we're going to go bottom left with everything. And that's 988 across the board. That's good. That means we can move this down to 1,000. And let's go top right with everything. 2012. Good, good, good. Stick high threshold. We can move to 2,000. And do we have an RSSI channel? Looks like it's AUX 4. Yes, it is. AUX 4. We're going to add a little bit of dead band just because my transmitter is getting a little old, or my gimbals are getting a little old, and we're going to save it. AUX 1, good. AUX 2, and AUX 3. Fan-friggin-tastic. And I also changed the auto smoothness down here to 20. That's recommended to just further smooth the RC command. Coming here to modes, and it looks like they already have some of them set up here. That is good to go. Angle mode I do not use. Horizon mode I do use as a OF switch, and I use it in when AUX 2 is all the way up, so that's good. Beeper we're going to add to AUX 3 all the way down with the switch. OSD disable, there it is. So OSD disable, we're going to put on AUX 2 in the fully forward position, which is like the normal position that I fly in, so that when I go fully forward on this switch, it'll shut the OSD off, and then if I go into the middle of the switch right above the throttle, it'll turn the OSD back on. Air mode, I do kind of the same thing with. Why do they have it on AUX 3? I'm going to put it on AUX 2, and I run air mode in the middle and down. I turn air mode off when I go to angle mode. FPV angle mix. Why do they have that on? No. I don't even know what that is. FPV angle mix? What the hell's that? Flip over after crash is on 3, but I want to pull it back a little bit here. And yeah, Frank, I don't know why I'm TAER, but everything I've ever had has been TAER, and a bunch of the people I fly with are also on TAER, so I don't really question it. And then launch control, just for funsies, is on AUX 2 right in the middle there. Disable VTX, Acro Trainer, Paralyze, Pit Mode, Pre-Arm. Nope, we're good. So that's all of my switches. Now we're going to figure out which motors are spinning the right direction and which motors are spinning the wrong direction. And then we're going to have to go back into BL Heli. Because I forgot. Or the motors aren't going to work. Hey, no, there they go. Okay. Alright, so arrow up is how you can just very slowly get them to the point where they spin. And you can get them to the point where they spin so slow that you can literally see what direction they're spinning, which is pretty awesome. So that one is going correctly. This one I kind of can't tell, but I can feel it. It is spinning wrong. So motor 3 is wrong. Motor 1 is correct. And motor 2 is wrong. So motors 2 and 3 need to... A little weird that they're showing 100% error, but we'll worry about that in a second. BL Heli, do you want to be cool, or are you going to be a jerk? What do you guys think? Cool or jerk? Well, it didn't select USB modem, so I'm betting on jerk. No, hey, look at it. Now it's totally fine. All right, so 2, I need to go from normal to reversed, and 3, I need to go from normal to reversed. We're going to right setup, and done. All right, disconnect. Ba-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba, they say, because they now have RPM filtering. Motors, and on, and let's see. Yep, motor 3 is correct. Motor 2 is correct. Very weird that they're showing 100% error. I've not really seen that before. That's weird. I'm just gonna ignore it for the time being. And we'll see what happens. Maybe I missed something. I mean, the motors are still spinning. I would think that if they had 100% air, they wouldn't want to spin. This is a text document of all my OSD stuff. Well, I mean, and notes to myself. But so I can just drop all of my OSD settings into the CLI all at once.
Telemetry lost.
And magical things will happen. All right.
Telemetry lost. Telemetry
okay, recovered. I think this battery's shot. I've now killed two batteries just sitting here, so it's not going to be much of a maiden, but hey. Two batteries on the maiden is better than none. Motors! Here, and... Wait, no, not motors. What am I doing? OSD. And I don't need power to it anymore either. Let's get these back onto a charger. Because maybe it'll take so long to fly it that these batteries can recharge by the time we're ready for them. All right, there's one, and here is two. Charge fast, you little beta FPV board. Okay, so there we go. I got most of my stuff in the OSD. Some of the other things that I like to add are the pitch angle. I'm always curious to see what angle I'm... Every once in a while, I'll just sort of like, I wonder what angle I'm flying at. I wonder how far I'm pitched forward. And then battery current draw. I wonder if it has a current sensor. This is a way to find out. I'm going to cheat it. Nah, that's a good spot for it. Milliamp hours pulled, individual cell voltage, RSSI, and then warnings. And we're going to save. Total armed time. Alarm at 3 minutes, and we're good. That is almost the end. Okay, so now I need to figure out what VTX table the pinch camera uses. So let's come over here, and we're gonna go to FPV gear. There's the, wait, which one? I think I got this one. Yeah, is the one I got. Okay, so let's see what... let's see. Does it say TBS anywhere in here? Nope. Does it say Tramp anywhere in here? Nope. So... Ooh, a user manual. Wow. Holy cow. User manual. Oh, boy. I've streamed... Too many hours, I think, today. all right, come on. Tell me about smart audio. Please, please, please. Well, I mean, we can just try it. Have their own website for it? Oh, it's just a, it just pushes forward to it. Partnership between Dynamics and FX. Has anybody used this, anybody in the chat used this guy before? Talking about the canopies. Smart audio ready. Oh, come on. Yeah, Spaghetti Monster. Hell yeah, okay. Tell me. Which one? FXT, what do you use? What VTX table are you using? Damn. Alright, well, it is a fairly new camera, so I will take a guess and do... I'm going to do the... That's the Tramp table. That's not what I want. Let's go into quads. I thought I had them in manuals, didn't I? Oh, no. I have a separate folder called VTX tables. Yeah, I do. There they are. Okay, so let's try the Smart Audio 2.1 because it is a fairly new camera. Low power disarm on until first arm and save. That's it. That's the whole setup. Let's get Let's start screwing around. Ow! That VTX is getting hot. Okay. Goggles, where are you? There you are. Little fellas. Alright, here we go. Let's see if... and I'm going to give you guys a view of this in a minute, but I have a feeling that I'm not on the right one. Anyway. So, yeah. Just give me a second. Let me see if Smart Audio is working. Okay, so here's the menu and features. VTX SA. Oh, we might be good. Race band 8. 25 milliwatts set. Cross your fingers. Hey, no way. Wow. Your boy guessed it on the first shot. Confirm. Let's fly, people. All right. Get this thing bolted back together, and then we will smash it into stuff. What do you think? Come on. Okay. Woo! We're gonna make it. My LED lights are starting to go dead. My brain is starting to fry. But we got this, man. We're gonna finish strong here. Kristen, can you turn on some lights? Hey, there's some English. And do you want your mask?
Be careful, there's four bottles of wine on the counter.
Are they all open?
One of them's open.
All right. I have to try not to hit the wine, guys. That's the mission here. Mission, don't smash wine bottles. Although I think this thing... Oh, we got to get a weight on this, too. Oh, I'm so excited to weigh this. What's it going to weigh? Place your bets. Place your bets. What's it going to weigh all up? And I will give you guys... Oh, I forgot about the canopy again. I'll give you guys a weight on the on my current Ultimate Freestyle Tiny Whoop with the Nitro Nectar batteries. So the current Ultimate Freestyle Tiny Whoop is, get on there. A fatty! 30.9. Call it 31 grams. 31 grams for the fat. Although, what the hell? Yeah, 31 grams. Why is it... What? Oh, there's a little bit of sticky. That's right. I put a little sticky under there. I remember now. Okay. 31 fatty boy grams. Let me just... I just got to put this back on here. Otherwise, it's going to... It's going to ruin the stickiness of the Omagrip.
Okay. Good.
Thank you.
And I'm netted.
Kristen has her protective head covering on, and she turned on some lights for us. Where'd that canopy go? Here it be. Oh, if you put the screws through the canopy, then you can just push them. Okay. Yeah, so that's how you put that on. That's very easy. Got it. We're learning. New things, man. New things are hard. I mean, it's still kind of a... No, that's not bad. That's not bad at all. I take it all back. It's easy. I mean... Really, how often are you taking the canopy off anyway? Alright. And... Come on, find your little home. Thank you! Okay, let's get this canopy tucked in a little bit in the front here. There it goes. Okay, that dropped down nicely. And... Yeah, I got a little... I don't know, maybe it'll fix it when I get it. That's fine! Okay, let's see. So you guys know I'm not lying. Not that you can really see the numbers on that. Oh, no, I guess you can. Let's
tuck this up here. Oh, I gotta put the propellers on too. All right, hold on. Oh my god, I have to know. I have to know. Okay, dry. No, this propeller isn't all the way on. Can't cheat it. Can I balance it there? There we go. So dry, it looks like 22.2. And then with one of these big old batteries, 30.2. That is not much lighter. I thought that was going to be a lot lighter. So it's somewhat due to this. This is a heavy antenna, and I just have a linear whip on the other one. That's actually okay. I was when I was kind of thinking like, man, it's going to be way lighter. It's going to be hard to kind of bounce between them. I'm cool with this. I'm cool with fat whoops. We're flying freestyle here, right? We need the extra weight for the throw. All right, there's one. Here comes two. Just in case, you know, you guys can't count, I guess. And get you out of there, you little devil. And then we've got three and four. Frank says, I didn't see the clear props. Yep, that's because they were clear. Tiny Whoop battery. Let's see how this situation goes here. I don't know. Maybe that goes downwards. Ooh, lots of cable. I like. Battery moves a little bit in there, but it should be all right during flight. Well, only one thing to do now. Say it with me. Crash. Little guy, what do you got for me? You gonna fly like a happy little rat? What? What? Welcome to OpenTX. All right. Well, we're off to a good start at one arm. It is connected. So when things won't arm and your throttle is already all the way down, put your goggles on and see what it says. It might give you a message like RPM filter. Well then, okay. I may have forgotten to turn flip a switch, I guess. Let's check that. So this is a result of those motor tabs saying 100%. It was telling us this, but we ignored it, and now the goddamn board popped off the rear thing again.
Telemetry.
That's going to be a real issue. If every time I plug it in, this rear grommet pops off. That's going to frustrate me. So I'm gonna do something about that, I think. I don't know what, because I don't know what to do about that, but I'm gonna do something. Maybe I'll see if I have a grommet with a bigger, oh, for God's sakes, with a bigger glip-glop or something, I don't know. Or maybe it's just this USB cable. Maybe this USB cable just plugs in too hard. Oh my god, it does it every time now. Come on, bro.
Telemetry recovered.
Alright, well, that's fine. Great! And my goggles are going dead. Or they're just beeping three times and then not beeping anymore. Well, they're turned on. CPU load is 19%, so that's probably fine. Hmm.
I charged this goggle battery up like a day ago. And it's just decided to jump off cliff, apparently. Well, let's try this. I mean, fuck, come on, goggles. Alright, it's doing the beeps, and I'm pretty sure that I saw 0.71. 2.3? What? What? Flash all. 16.71. I wish this would work. I really wish that would work. Weird that it says 2.3. Not anymore, Frank. You're supposed to just be able to come here to flash all and select 16.71 and flash, but for some reason it's giving me this files unavailable nonsense. OH5 4823. What is this 2.3 nonsense? Let me look up the a date. See, February 3rd, 2020. That... Yeah, Tiago, you might be right, because this is in JESC. Yeah. Where is BL Heli's GitHub? Yeah, there's no space. Okay, that should find it. There we go. Okay, bit dump. I'm all about those bit dumps. Here we go. Media fire for flashing and configure. That's not it. Bit dump BL Heli. What do we got here? What are all these? No. Hex files, maybe? Come on, buddies. No, that's not it. I'm trying to not do JESC because it just kind of takes a while. Hex files 16.7. 4 years ago, 3 years ago. Come on, we're close. I can feel it. What was it, an O? It was an O, right? If I click O. Balls. Any second now, the amount of time that I'm saving trying to do this will go out the window from trying to do JESC. From just doing JESC. I've done JESC probably on about 20 ESCs. This does not look like the normal BL Heli that I'm used to seeing. What's the releases? Ah, now we're talking. Now we're talking. This is what I want. GitHub. Oh no, that's JESC again. Balls. Well, that's super annoying. Let's go GitHub Jazz Maverick. And we'll just grab it from there real quick. Okay, and we want to go to O. I think. Is that not how it works? That's not how it works. I've never actually gone to Jazz Maverick here before. 16.71, that's what we want. Wow, 16.73. Did you see that? Jeez. Oh, you know what it is? They don't have it for... Jazz Maverick doesn't have it yet. That's why it's not working. Okay. Okay. So they haven't done a an OH5 in Jazz Maverick yet. F G H I J K L M N O P. Yeah, H to P. Oh, well, that's a shame. All right. Well, this way we'll double the time. What's this though? 16.77. Jeez. Oh, there's some OHs. OH5. Hey, look at that. And it's 48. Now, the question is, will BL Heli on the tower select file manually and actually work this time? Place your bets. So this is the one that we just got. No, it's not. 1106, that's the one that we just got. Open, and hey, that's how it's supposed to work. Look at that. It was all meant to be. It was meant to be so that in this live stream, you guys would get to see what it looks like when these purple bars go from not filled up to filled up. Oh, God. Ooh, another one. Wow. That one's going fast. Look at this. This is everything right here, guys. This is everything. All right, ready. And next one. Oh, wait, I can't. Oh, boy. There it is. Your guys' eyes bleeding yet? All right. And we're good. Now we can fly.
Telemetry recovered.
But first, I want to try to figure out how to get this board back down on the rear grommet. Because it ain't going to fly right with the back of the board bashing against a screw. So let's do this, and then I'll just kind of show you guys what I'm up to here. So I need to pull this board down. Come on. I'm kind of pulling it down with the USB port, which is not great. Okay. All right, get down. Get down and in there. Get on that grommet. Get in there. Come on. Get on that grommet, please. Get in the little... Are you too good for your home? Ooh, there it goes. There it goes. Yeah, I'm going to have to look and see if I have a grommet with... My God, every single thing in the world is beeping and screaming and...
Inactivity alarm.
Keep saying that. Say that 15 more times, QX7, and I will bash you with a hammer.
Inactivity alarm.
There you go. There's one. Keep it going.
Telemetry lost.
Telemetry lost. Come on. Give me some more warnings.
Inactivity.
Oh, good. That's a good one there. Inactivity alarm. Thanks for that.
Inactivity
alarm. Ooh, yeah. Give it to me again. Come on. Give it. There. You happy now? Oh, my God. Aw, why is it clicking? What are you clicking against? Don't click. Don't do that. What are you clicking against? Oh my God, what's happening? What the hell's clicking? All right, turtle mode. Shouldn't be that one. No. This one. Hear it? These motors make some jam, even though they click. It sounds like maybe I didn't screw this down or something, I guess? No, it's screwed down. Well, maybe it'll just stop clicking. Oh my God, what happened?
Wow. Hello.
This is an excited quad.
Quad, quad, quad.
Jesus. All right, let's try that again. Hey, it flies, and the fan's blowing on it. So it's all over the place. Oh, the fan, the fan. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We built a thing that can't compete with the fan. All right, let's fly. Josh with a $10 super chat. Thank you, Josh. Very, very cool of you. Much, much, much appreciated. It's people like Josh that allow me to do this. And for that, I am very grateful, Josh. You are the man. Very cool of you. If you guys like what I'm doing here, I do have a Patreon page. That's where I really put the secrets. It is linked down below in the description. I promise you'll save more money from reading my tips and tricks than it'll cost you to be on there. What do you think of that? It'll actually cost you money to not join my Patreon, guys. That's basically what's going on. You will go broke not joining my Patreon. That's what's going to happen. All right. Here we go. Let me turn off the... there we go. Turn that off. I'm also going to turn this off to drop that down. My goggles have magically stopped beeping. Oh, nope, there it goes. As soon as I picked them up, they started beeping again. That's interesting. I have no idea why that's happening. It really confuses me why they do that. And it just started. I do have a replacement goggle battery on the way. This goggle battery is the better part of 2 years old. Hey, look, it's got a... it's got ESC telemetry. That's pretty cool. All right. Whoa, whoa, okay. What's happening? Oh, my God. The yaw is so... Wow, I can't... Okay, hold on. Something's happened here. Okay, rate profile 2. Stop. I don't change the rate profile or the PID profile unless I tell you to. Oh, what the hell? That was weird. Oh, that's way better. Way better. Very yellow. What's with the yellow? Wow, this feels way different. Oh god, what's happening? Oh, it knocked the yellow out of it. Look at that. All you gotta do is crash and it'll knock the yellow clean out of it. It's very yellow. What is up with that? Good power, really good power. Let's take a look at Kristen wearing her protective headnet. There she is. Hard at work, I'm assuming.
Yep.
Whew. All right, let's do some flying. Oh boy. That's the kitchen. So, durability testing has begun. Okay. And has continued. Let's check out my skinny leg gap. Skinny leg gap coming up. Struggling a little. Woo! Wait, let me make sure I didn't knock that over. Oh, I did! That's the water bottle. Oh, God! Oh, God, water! Oh, no, it's empty. I was gonna say, geez, how hard must it have hit it? Oh, man. Very strange. I've never had one of these little tiny cameras have such a hard time with the white balance. Very weird. Usually you just need to look at the incandescent yellow light for a second. Yeah, see, it's trying. It's trying to... Yeah, it's a little bit better. You know what it also probably is? I have a mix. So this is an incandescent bulb up here that the apartment came with. Oh, that's really weird, though. When I get close to the bulbs, it finds the right white balance, but then... Oh, I should not have disarmed. That was stupid. But then it, Woo! That was a tasty one there. Battery's getting a little low. Whoop! Low battery, eh? How low is it? 3.0? That's not too bad. Let's see if turtle mode is working. Whoop, nope. Oh, you jerk. Alright. Let's go over there. Ah! Oh, man. Come on, please. Let me just get a little bit. What kind of voltage you got? Please. Oh, no, it's not going to come back. All right, we got one more battery.
Battery. Telemetry lost.
All right, so first impressions are way easier to fly than the 25 million kV Happy Model motors. 25,000 kV is actually what they are. Much easier. Ooh, I gotta talk a little quieter. I'm peeking the shit out of the mic. Way easier. Still a big old heaping scoop of power. But yeah, like those 25,000s, it's I mean, it's like a rocket ship. It's ridiculous. It's a lot. It's a lot. And like, I would not recommend those motors to anyone that hasn't flown for a couple years. Many batteries. This, on the other hand, is, I mean, like, it's a lot, but what the hell is going, why does it, you gotta be fucking kidding me. Stop going to rate profile 2, what the hell? What the fuck, now it won't, what? Alright, it's acting a little weird, but, oh my god, what, it's still not, what the, what? Come on, dude, what? Okay, it decided, so, what is going, it's, there's telemetry, there's low battery, what the hell is going on here? A lot of warnings, guys, a lot of warnings. Not really sure why. See if I can hit it, nope, ooh! Can I hit it backwards? What if I hit it backwards, will you guys send me $1,000? Look at it climb, though, man. Oh, my God. These motors have good power. These motors have really good power. Those iFlight motors are going to really have to work to keep up with these. Woo! See if we can find the cat. Where's the cat at? Here we go.
He's sleeping in the
bedroom. Oh, he's sleeping in the bedroom, Kristen says. Ah, she shut the door. Shut down. Woo, boy. That was a sketchy power. She looks so funny wearing her little head net. Oh, boy. Oh. Caught it. We're good. Everything's fine. Woo. Ooh, nothing's fine. Wall ride. Ooh. I got to do that wall ride now more often. That's fun. So yeah, I didn't have to add, so those Happy Model motors are so crazy that you have to add, oh, you can't tell me that didn't look sick. Oh my god, I'm gonna, nope. Yeah, you literally have to run a throttle curve on those Happy Model motors. They are like unflyable without it. And on these, I do not have a throttle curve, and they feel fine, like. I'm gonna get good at hitting this tiny little gap, and it's gonna be absolutely ridiculous. I'm gonna change the world forever. Boink! Oh, keep going! Whop! Oh yeah. This is fun. This flies really nice. It's got, I would say like 90% of the power, but it doesn't. It's not like just trying to hold on for dear life all the time like those motors. It's just like you go full throttle and it's just mayhem. Oh boy, I think this battery's going dead. Oh no. I hate when they get stuck like this. Stop it. Come on, let me just inch it out. The batteries don't seem to be lasting all that long. Right?
Low battery.
Where'd it go? There it is. Alright. So let's any idea how long? I don't know. Who freaks out? Who freaks out? Nobody freaks out. Yeah, man, that is lively. I don't know if I can feel the difference in weight, but it just works, man. It just flies really well right out of the box. Damn, those motors are very impressive. They have like plenty of power, all the power that I want. And yeah, I don't know. That's really good. I'm digging that. I don't so the Happy Model motors are on the Betaflight setup, which is a little bit heavier, as we saw, about a gram heavier. But this is the big magical thing on here. This is an Insta360 Go holder. So these 25 million KV motors, like this is the perfect rig for them. This rig doesn't have the ability, like this loop is held on by these two little things that are these two little hooks that are in the cockroach frame. This frame doesn't have those, so this frame could never have that loop. So this rig is not going to carry an Insta360 Go. It's just going to be exactly this. And it's kind of perfect. I really thought that I would want more power and that I would end up going to those 25,000s, but no. That feels great. Like, there was not a single moment that I had a thought of. I've crashed into her hair twice now, Cage. First time was pretty nasty. Second time wasn't nearly as bad. I've never crashed into her hair with a brushless rig, though. Just brushed. And that's why she has that hairnet. So, yeah, this is... And this canopy is fine. I mean, I wish you guys could feel these new canopies on Tiny Whoop's website... They specifically did say that they're thicker now, and they're not kidding, man. Those old canopies were very, very thin. This is not that. This is really firm. Not quite as stiff as the Goober canopy from Newbie Drone. This thing is, like, full-blown indestructible. Like, I think you could run this over with a car, and the canopy would just smile and be like, yo, thanks for the butt massage. But yeah, this Tiny Whoop canopy is no slouch. This is really, really sturdy. This is legit. This might actually be the ultimate freestyle Tiny Whoop. The Happy Model 25,000 KV motors are also not on bearings. These motors are on bearings, so these motors should be more efficient and just straight up more durable down the road. This F4 AIO board, I know that some people have had issues, but this one was totally fine. So, yeah, I mean, as usual, my recommendation is to buy your stuff from GetFPV or Pyrodrone or RDQ so that you can return it. You know, those companies have really good customer service. So, yeah, if you buy this flight controller from one of those resellers and it's no good, just send it back and we'll send you one. You'll get a good one. The antenna was giving me great video. The video looked really good. The white balance thing is kind of interesting with the camera. That's going to take some either getting used to or playing around with. I could just fix it in post, but the problem is every time I'm getting close to a light bulb, it's going out of yellow. And, well, you know what's interesting? We have all... You can see it. Which way do I put my hand to point? There it is. Oh, you can see we have warm incandescent light bulbs. And then I have
daylight balanced in here. So interesting. I'm gonna have to play around with that a little bit. That's kind of it. Everything else is rad. Shit, I didn't even need to tune it. The tune was like locked, right? And that's the tune that they sent with me putting a little bit more. No way on the daylight bulbs, Ted. Daylight bulbs make me like inside the house. Daylight bulbs are gross, in my opinion. Please don't forget to update video description. Post the links. Done, Frank. Is this it? Is this the ultimate tiny whoop for freestyle? Could be. Could be. It's got the lightest camera. Beautiful canopy. These canopies come in a million different colors. Wow. And BT 2.0. BT 2.0. I bet you that's why this flies. I bet you that's why this feels like this has so much power. So on this rig, it's not BT 2.0. It's the regular old JST, old school, because that's what the Nitro Nectar batteries run. That could have something to do with it. BT 2.0 might have made up the gap between these 22,000 kV motors and the 25,000s. That's pretty interesting. Specs again, Night Train, are it's pretty much all Beta FPV. It's the Beta FPV 1S board, which is really light because it's got the sides cut out more. It's Beta FPV's 0802 22,000 kV motors, the new ones that are in bearings. This is the Tiny Whoop canopy. This is the Tiny Whoop pinch camera. And this is a TrueRC singularity antenna. The antenna so we could probably save a half a gram or so by just going to a linear antenna, I would bet. And that would further break up the weight difference between these two. There's already a gram and change, I think it was, difference. That would make a big difference, dropping a half a gram there. Other than that, though, and I'll take that half a gram for better video. Damn. Ultimate freestyle tiny whoop. This might be it. And this Meteor 65 frame is, according to all the racers, the frame. It's definitely the lightest frame, but they say it's also the strongest frame. And I pounded the shit out of one of these, a black one of these frames, and it just didn't care. Whoo! I'm gonna send this thing up some buildings downtown Atlanta. What do you think about that? Because I'll have crisp video the whole time. The only thing that's gonna be suspect is the radio link. But if you want to build the ultimate brushless whoop, this might be it, man. I'm gonna call this video and jump into the description and add as many affiliate links as I possibly can. For all the parts and pieces. Yeah, I mean, crossfire, but then you're adding another like 2 to 3 grams, and on a tiny whoop, that's really rough to add that much weight. So I would never really do crossfire on a tiny whoop. I don't think you could get far enough to need the crossfire with how slow they go with just a single battery. You need to have somebody on the other side plugging in a battery to send you home. Maybe if they built crossfire into the board, sure. But that's pretty impressive. Here it is one more time for you. That's what it looks like. The ultimate freestyle tiny whoop. If you disagree, you're wrong. Thanks for hanging out, everybody. I cannot believe that this took 3.5 hours, but hey, sometimes builds take forever. You just gotta keep going, and eventually they'll be done, and then you can smash them and spend the rest of your time fixing them. That's one of the things that's great about this hobby. You can break all your stuff and then just fix it. And it doesn't cost you an arm and a leg. Thanks for hanging out, everybody. You guys are awesome. What did we end up with? How many people do we have? Let's see. Yeah, let's not obsess over numbers. You guys are awesome. I love every single one of you. Thanks for hanging out. I'm going to fix this description, and next week we're going to have another Whoop Wednesday, and next week's going to be fun because we're going to compare this guy with the 75mm props to this guy with the crazy 20 banana motors to the ultimate freestyle Whoop, and I think I can even build one more. I think I can build a Beta FPV 2S Whoop, and I'll put it in a cockroach frame because a 2S Whoop with an Insta360 Go, that might be the move. That might be really fun. We'll see. We'll find out. Thanks for hanging out, everybody. You guys are awesome. My name's Aaron Ciotti. Everybody calls me Ciotti. If you don't, I will come to your house and knock on your door. Be good. And just remember, when the builds get tough,
諦めんだよ、お前。どうしてそこでやめるんだ、そこで。もう少し頑張ってみろよ。ダメダメダメダメ、諦めたら周りのこと思えよ。応援してる人たちのこと思ってみろって。あともうちょっとのところなんだから。俺だってこのマイナス10のところ、しじみが取れると頑張ってんだよ。絶対やってみろ。必ず目標達成できる。だからこそ言えばいいんだ。
Goodbye! Love you guys. Be good. See you guys tomorrow, probably. Or Friday.